Good afternoon, everyone. We're going to get started. Sorry to startle you. We're just getting our mic situated. My name is Michael J. Gray II. I'm a senior here at the university, major in political science. I'm originally from Rochester, New York. Today, I am honored and have the privilege to introduce Dr. Daryl G. Smith. Dr. Smith will spend her time with us today and tomorrow to talk about the topic of diversity as an imperative to excellence. Dr. Smith is a professor of education and psychology at Claremont Graduate University in Claremont, California. Prior to assuming her current faculty position at Claremont, Dr. Smith served as a college administrator in planning and evaluation, institutional research, and student affairs. Her current research, teaching, and publications have been in areas of organizational implications of diversity, assessment and evaluation, leadership and change, governance and diversity, and STEM fields, and faculty diversity as well. Dr. Smith is the author of numerous articles and publications examining the challenges, effectiveness, and opportunities of diversity in higher education. She has served as an evaluator and a consultant to numerous projects and campuses across the country and to foundations, including the Ford Foundation, as well as the Pew Charitable Trust. She is currently serving as an evaluator on an advisory committee of several NSF advanced grants. Dr. Smith also served as one of the three principals responsible for the evaluation of campus diversity initiative for the James Irvine Foundation in collaboration with the Association of American Colleges and Universities. This five-year project involved working with 28 private colleges and universities in California to develop their capacity to sustain and monitor progress in institutional diversity. That project resulted in a final report, three research briefs, and a resource kit for campuses and a monograph, Making a Real Difference with Diversity, a Guide to Institutional Change. Dr. Smith's work hasn't been limited by country boundaries, as she has worked with universities in India and South Africa. She most recently was the winner of the 2013 Distinguished Alumni Award from Claremont Graduate University. Dr. Smith received her bachelor's degree in mathematics from Cornell University, right here in New York, a master's degree in student personnel and counseling at Stanford University, and her doctorate from Claremont in psychology and higher education. Will you give Dr. Smith a warm welcome?
Thank you, everyone. I got a little disoriented because this was up here. Can you all hear me okay? If I, at any point in the back, if you can, just do something, all right? One of my fears when I do, you know, we're going to be together for quite some time this afternoon, and I want to make sure that your time is well spent and that I can be helpful. So I want to engage you all along. If there are any questions or things that you want to push against, please do, and there'll be opportunity to do that. So we have a two-part agenda today. In the first part, during this lunch period, I'm really going to be setting the context and the imperative for excellence. And I'm sort of driving in a slightly different way that I do it than Alma did this morning for those of you who are here. But they're quite complementary. And I think you'll begin to see why I think, because I do a lot of work on institutional change, that we have to understand how this is an imperative. And I'll walk you down that a little bit. And then in the second part, what's emerging from all the work on diversity across the country is this weird thing called, how do we know we're making progress? And I want to give you some sort of ways of thinking about that that are not complicated, that don't require $7 billion, but that actually allow the institution to talk about, are we making progress and where? And I'll give you some ways to think about it. I've spent a bit of time with your data to the degree that I could get it. So I'll show it some key points back to you, and then we can talk about that as well. So the first part of this, setting the context, and this is very, very important to understand. We have 50 years of unfinished business with respect to diversity in this country, and that primarily has to do with historically underrepresented groups. This is the history, this is where the conversation about diversity began now 50 years ago. And if any of you have seen The Butler, it's a sort of a quick move through history that is not then and is still now. And I want to say this because it is unfinished business. And it is very important as we begin to talk about diversity as more inclusive, which it needs to be, that we not forget the unfinished business of our work on diversity, particularly in this country. Having said that, we've made progress. There is no question at all, and we have to honor that we have made progress. And now we have the great challenge of these increasing domains for our diversity conversation. And it is one of the conceptual things that become very important as we move forward. So I'll just give you the laundry list of some of them. As you look at this list, I want you to think about it not simply as the list. We are a sensitive place with respect to a religion, but also the here the role of religion. And for me, one of the most, this has been true for a long time. Academic communities have been a little reluctant to know what to do about that. But for me, I'm going to use the word capacity quite a bit this afternoon. And let me give you a moment where capacity was an issue. After 9/11 in this country, most of our campuses were found with very little capacity to have intelligent conversations about Islam. After 9/11, we had pretty awful conversations nationally. People were ignorant, people made assumptions, and on our campuses, and I think this was probably true here, we looked desperately around the community to see if there was anybody thoughtful who we could bring on campus to have a conversation about Islam and what it was and what it wasn't, right? That continues to this day in terms of what is our capacity as higher education institutions to do the work of today? And the role of religion is one of them. And I'm an old New Yorker. I was born and raised in New York. Let's imagine you having a conversation about the Middle East, shall we? Not such an easy one. Yes? So religion is now something that we must engage in the context of diversity conversations. The issue about political structures and access to power. If you look around the world, we have a lot of examples of where diversity can be pretty frightening. And part of it is the increasing press around the world, but including in this country as well, concerns about political structure and who has access to power and who doesn't. These are very much part of our diversity conversations. Who has access to power, who has access to resources, and who doesn't. Human rights and equity issues, of course, are growing all over the country, and our recent discussions about equity issues with respect to gay marriage, et cetera, got discussions in communities all the country about transgendered issues, but at any rate, the human rights and equity umbrella is now something that is not easily just put off to the side. Dealing with the histories of violence and injustice is a very important aspect of how it is we move forward. I would generalize to say that in the US, both educationally and culturally, we have been very reluctant to deal with history. You know, we're sort of have this sort of very present moment focus. So what happens is if somebody wants to talk about the history of slavery, other people will say, well, that was a long time ago. Can't we get over it? So whatever one's own history of injustice is, we have a hard time in this country dealing with it. But it turns out around the world, this is part of one of the important strategies, if you will, about how do we move forward. Every country, society, has some history, whether it's Ireland and Protestants and Catholics, which for us in this country is a little bit of a, we wouldn't imagine it, but you know, go to the Middle East and you see it. So how we deal with histories of violence and injustice turns out to be an important condition under which we move forward on diversity issues. Of course, sexual orientation is now a common part of our diversity domains, and increasingly gender identity. Now, I used to teach a doctoral seminar in human development, and because I care about diversity, diversity is embedded in everything I do because intellectually it's important. We talked about gender identity at a time when most people didn't even understand what it was. Well, now you can't go to a college campus where there isn't at least a beginning conversation about gender-neutral bathrooms. So you wouldn't have your bathrooms like this if that conversation began. So gender identity is now part of that. And of course, we had some discussion this morning about disabilities, varying abilities, and the issues that go associated with that. We have been through one of the biggest waves of immigration in this country since the early 1900s and the mid-1900s. And as a result, the fabric of our society has fundamentally altered demographically from a racial and ethnic point of view, particularly with increasing immigrant communities, not only from Central America and South America, Mexico, Asia, of course. So immigration has meant that we have now intersected our traditional categories of race and ethnicity with people from all around the world who come from different racial and ethnic categories in our terms. Multiple and intersecting identities turns out to be one of the most important conceptual tools moving forward. Alma said this morning, for those of you who were here, we have multiple identities. So I'm going to ask you, and we're going to negotiate this, the sound, and this I don't need you to feedback, but I'm going to try to be good if you have questions or comments that I'll repeat it so that the mic person can get it. But just do this in your head. If I were to ask you to think about your identities and which of them are really salient to you, if someone said, well, who are you? And you listed your identities, think about that for a moment. And I want you just to count how many are on your list. Not of every possible identity you could have, but the ones that really matter to you. Okay? All right, how many of you have only one identity that you listed? How many of you had five or so, 3 to 5? How many of you had as many as 10? Okay, so what happened is most hands went up with multiple identities. The fact is that even though, because of our histories, we have been very comfortable with taking identities one at a time, right? There's a race discussion, a gender discussion, the reality is we are intersecting identities. You know, and if you're in a group of white women and you're the only African American, I could pretty much guess that race is popping up as an important salient category. On the other hand, if you're in a group of African Americans and you're the only woman, you're a gender identity. And we can intersect that with sexuality, with class, etc. So this becomes very important and actually becomes a tool for how we begin to build communities that work. Indigenous communities, and I'm very conscious I'm in New York, and I want to even underscore this more. You know, the native communities in this country, and when we aggregate underrepresented minorities, you know, whatever's going on in our native communities usually gets lost. And I've made a personal commitment that I'm going to disaggregate all of these. And to just mention here, and I will again, the issues and diversity about indigenous communities, and this is true around the world, and the viability of indigenous communities, the sovereignty issues, and the attention to needs in those communities. And this is a very important thing. And when I think about upstate New York, I think about the history of native communities and the degree to which public and private institutions are addressing issues and growth and vitality in those communities. So that's an important domain. Now, science and technology is one of our pressing national crises. Our domestic capacity in science is terrifyingly low. And here's one little factoid for you. 87% of the Asians in this country getting their PhDs are not citizens, which means the number of Asian Americans getting their PhDs is lower than the number of African Americans getting their PhDs. We are not building our domestic capacity in science. And as a result, most of our campuses now are concerned about STEM. the national government is very concerned about this. I mean, if you think it's wonderful to educate the world, and we will continue to play that role, but what's happening in the world is that every country in the world is building their higher education systems. So now, for the first time in a long time, people have viable options home. And we're just walking around thinking we don't need to pay attention to this. So the STEM issues, the science, technology, engineering, mathematics issues, are pressing in terms of diversity issues. It also then intersects with concerns about building our capacity for those wanting to go in the health professions. You know, in order to go into medicine, you sort of have to do organic chemistry. Well, that's a STEM field. And if we're not doing very well in these fields, we're not producing the capacity of people to go do what they hope to do. And then, of course, we have demographic change. And I'm going to do a parallel with technology in a minute, and you're going to see why you're going to laugh in a minute. But our demographic shifts. So the first thing to point out here is this is the US adult population in 2009. And see, I'm not sitting down there doing the click, this is a light thing. But basically, the left pie chart of the younger adults in the country as of 2009. This isn't a future projection. This isn't 30 years down the road. Less than 60% are white. You've got 19% who are Latino, 14% African American. This is as of 2009. And this is where you laugh, because I created my slide presentation on a Mac. And what you have here is a PC. So why that, which says New York State demographic population 2010 on my computer? I think just a bunch of curse words. I hope they're not mad at New York. But at any rate, this is the demographic profile of New York State. And again, under 60% white, 16% black, 18% Latino. Our country has fundamentally changed. There isn't a place you can go in the country where it doesn't look like this. It's no longer California and Texas or Florida. This is how New York looks as of 2010. And this is sort of the world in which we are now living. And this is not even the young adult population. Asian, 7%. So part of the mental image is if we look around this room of leaders at University of Albany and ask, how, just from a racial and ethnic point of view, how are we doing? Probably less diverse than New York State. Very important as we move forward. Now this all has profound implications, and this is part of the context I want to set for today. This has profound implications for the health and well-being of societies. This is no longer about doing things so that some groups feel good. I mean, forgive me if I use harsh language. This is not I'm going to be nice to some populations so they feel better. This is fundamentally about the health and well-being of our democracy. And what the political scientists, and this is where it gets academic, if you want to look at research in political science on stability, one of the most powerful predictors of stability in a society is, negatively, the increased inequities in that society aligned with particular identities. Now, in some parts of the world, race is not a particular, if you go to Nigeria, this is not about race, but it may be about tribe, or language, or religion, yes? So the research is pretty clear around the world that you can measure stability in a society by the growth of inequity in key indicators in that society. So, let me ask you, how happy would we be to live in an environment, in a society, which was politically, violently unstable? Anybody want to go there? We can look around the world and see them. We don't have to imagine. It's when we look about diversity and we say, does diversity work? What we know is it's the conditions under which diversity works and the conditions under which diversity doesn't work. And if you want to look around the world, look at lots of examples of conditions under which it doesn't work. So part of what I'm going to give you today is how do we create the conditions that works? But what's important here is doing it well has profound implications for the well-being of our society, for all of us. We know that if we are going to erase health and education disparities, We better do better at educating diverse populations. The health professions now, if you, Alma again mentioned the AAMC, if you look at medical conversations about strategic issues, one of the first strategic issues is health disparities. It's not a diversity plan. They're not putting it over here and saying, well, when we get to diversity, this is what we'll talk about. It's actually a medical crisis. We have lack of access to health care aligned with various communities, racial and ethnic communities, class communities, that mean that people don't have access to health care, number one. And the medical profession has said, we don't have the diversity of medical professionals, number two. And the third is we don't have any medical, we don't have sufficient medical professionals who have the competence to engage the diversity that they are going to encounter in their professional work. So if I'm a person going into a profession, the question is my university preparing me to engage the complexity of the people with whom I'm going to work? And of course, this plays out not only in health, but in law and in certainly in education, right? So health and education disparities. We think it's important as a society to address them, which clearly has become a national crisis. Then we better do something about it. Vibrant democracies that work. We have a, there is a vision shared by Nelson Mandela in South Africa about vibrant democracies that work. And fundamentally, vibrant democracies that work are democracies that have embraced their diversity. Citizen engagement. Let's face it, folks, if you feel disempowered, you don't engage. You don't engage, you don't vote, you don't vote, you get what you ask for. And of course, now what we're seeing is that the credibility and viability of higher education is at stake. What's happening all over the country, you know, you are a public university and you're in Albany. I don't know the campus. It's actually my first time here, it's interesting. But I would bet that the legislators in New York State have a fine time picking on you when you do or don't do something they think you should or shouldn't do. Is that a fair? Yeah. So our credibility and our viability for the society, the degree to which we can call upon the society for public support, the fact that really I think if our campuses can't do this well, what hope is there for New York City, Los Angeles, Chicago? If we can't do this well, we are not going to have the capacity. All your student leaders are going to go out and either be those leaders we need or replicate the past. And we know what that looks like. So here's what it looks like on many campuses. The rhetoric about diversity is increasing. Yes? We're getting more diverse, so we better pay attention to it. The list of diversity identity grows. So we started down the list, right? Race, gender, sexual orientation, age, religion. Did I leave anything out that somebody is sort of ability issues? Any pressing issue that we should remember? Yes?
Veterans,
absolutely. Thank you, sir. And this is where diversity keeps changing, doesn't it? We now pay attention to vets. We should pay attention. You know, the GI Bill was, despite its structural inequities with respect to race, was the engine, and here's the key. It wasn't just the engine for those individuals who came back from World War II. It was the engine for our society. The United States today is what it is today because of the GI Bill. That was an investment of national funds in those people, and we reaped some rewards. Was it inequitable? Yes, because it turned out, if you lived in the South, you didn't quite get the access if you were a black soldier. But veterans now are an important part. And when you want to push diversity in veterans, don't forget the women. Because many campuses, the image is these are male veterans. Well, in fact, there's a lot of diversity within the veterinary community, the veterans community. So thank you for that. So the identities are growing, and let me tell you, they're going to continue to grow. We haven't checked off done, 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 so we can move on. Programs and projects are growing. So what happens on our campus? We have an issue, we create a program. I assume that's true here. Tamara, is that sort of a true? We have an issue and we create a program. The instinct we have is projects and programs to address diversity issues. What we see is that our undergraduate student diversity is growing. In most campuses, graduation rate disparities exist, and I'll show you yours in a bit. But the human capacity to engage these growing list of things and growing list of issues has not grown. So my guess is every time someone says, you know, we need a mentoring program for, or more advisors for the veterans coming back, or we don't just add people. Have you been growing with staff and faculty? You're just probably starting now, but during the financial crisis in particular, we were cutting, we weren't adding. So now think about this. The identity list is growing, the list of ideas of projects and programs is growing, but the capacity to address them is not growing. And the leadership for many of these diversity programs and projects coming from people who have diversity in their title. And I can assure you, and again, I don't know this place, so you could tell me I'm wrong, I can assure you that hasn't been growing. So it's on the backs of the same few people to do more and more with less and less. Now here's one that really gets me, and again, I'll take a risk and assume it's true here. Conversation, task force, committees, and reports could be 40 to 50 years old. In other words, I go to a campus and I try to do my homework. And I didn't this time because I'm getting a little tired of doing it. Ask for old diversity reports. I got the new one. But I bet that whenever the last task force was set up and a report was written, there's a pretty good alignment between what was recommended then and what's recommended in this. So all we need to do is change the date, wave it around, and now we've got a new report. And that's been true for 40 to 50 years. I can tell you because I've been doing this work that long. And here's what the killer is. We have competing views of whether progress is being made. Now, I have to tell you, I know a lot about college administration. If I'm a leader, provost, president, dean, I have to mark progress. I mean, I'm not going to go to my board or to the community and say, oh, we failed at this, we failed at this, we're not doing well over here, right? I'm going to mark progress. So I'm going to pick, so let's say here, just given what I've seen, you're certainly going to pick how diverse your undergraduate student body is. And you're going to be very proud of the 30%, and there's a large number of historically underrepresented communities. In other words, not in California, that's mostly Asian communities. But you've got large percentages of historically underrepresented communities as undergraduates. So if I'm the president, I'm going to mark progress. If I care about diversity, I'm going to mark where we're not making progress, right? I'm going to go, but. Well, what happens in our conversations on our campuses is we do this to each other. And if you're in New York, you probably shoot barbs at each other, because this is New York. Your president came from Minnesota, a culture of nice. I don't think anybody thinks New York is guilty of a culture of nice. But the problem with that is, after a while, if every time I stand up and say, making progress, somebody shoots it down, after a while, it just gets much more fun to go talk about the new building we just built. And I'm very serious about that. And what that does is absolutely suck the air out of change. And the problem is, of course, I care about the things I'm showing we're not doing, and the leader wants to show the things we are doing, and we're talking past each other. So part of what I want to set out today is how can we stop talking past each other and move forward, in which you begin to say, we've made progress here, yay, but not so much here. Let's focus on it. Yes? So this is very, very important, and it's a pattern we've gotten into in higher education of standing back, leaders speak, and again, they have to speak positive change. I mean, that's why they're in that role, and we just shoot it down. And it gets very hard to sustain the hard work that was mentioned this morning about diversity efforts. In addition, diversity efforts are often parallel to the real stuff we do. So it's parallel to strategic plans, it's parallel to accreditation, it's parallel to unit plans. So if you think about your unit, whatever you're part of, and you think about the last time you had a program review or a self-study, where was diversity in that plan? In too many cases, It's not in that plan. It's in some other plan. And my hypothesis, and I think I have pretty good data to support this, is if it's not in that plan, it ain't going to happen. Diversity efforts are often mobilized after a crisis. So I often come to a campus, and now we're paying attention because we have a crisis. And we call out the few folks we have who do diversity work. We expect them to solve the problem and settle everybody down so we can move on. We know that difficult dialogues are difficult, and I mentioned the Middle East. In California right now, the University of California, Irvine, cannot have a conversation about the Middle East. Can't. Bring a speaker from Israel, and the Muslim student union and student groups are upset. Bring a Muslim speaker, and the Jewish communities are upset. This is not how you make a pluralistic democracy work. This is how you create divisions and power wins, I suppose, at the end. So this is very important. How do we build our capacity to have those conversations, acknowledging our histories, acknowledging inequities, and moving forward? We've got a lot of work internationally on this, actually. And what we often find is that task forces, and again, I don't know if that's happened here, kind of get these diversity groups get overloaded with the lists of stuff to do and find themselves either with too much to do or just not even knowing what to do. So struggling with overload and no direction. And now, and this is a thing you'll hear me jump up and down about, internationalization. Every campus I go on, globalization and internationalization. I think it's remarkable that and you'll hear a little facetiousness in me, and I'm in New York, so bear with me. Isn't it amazing, in the middle of the financial crisis, we have campuses, building campuses halfway around the world. And what happens with this, and don't misunderstand me, I think this issue of internationalization in an interconnected global community is terribly important. I've done some work in South Africa. I see the moments we are in. It's terribly exciting and important, but it is not in exchange for this diversity work. So you'll see a business school, for example, and has to have people from China, perfectly good, because we're going to go have a joint program, and I don't know where your joint programs are, but joint program in China. So we have to have faculty from China, who have roots in China, or at least speak Mandarin. And that's getting going. That's moving. And it's moving fast. Meanwhile, back at the diversity discussions, reasons and excuses. So just be aware of this. So, what do I think about the next generation of work? And I think it's very important to think, what does this next generation, we have an opportunity. I actually have never been so hopeful, and partly it's our demographic shifts. But we have to, Alma used the choir metaphor this morning, and many people raise the hand, part of the traditional choir on diversity, and my way of saying that is we need to sing in multi-part harmony, and we need to do better, and we need to reframe how we do what we're doing. And here's the frame for me. Building institutional capacity for a pluralistic society. This is not only about the people who have historically been committed to work on these issues. This is about what is our mission and what do we need to do to build our capacity to do the work of a pluralistic society as a research university in higher education. So that's the question. It's not my point of view or my attitude, it's that. So the way I like to think about this is reframing this. This is our credibility, our viability as institutions, and our capacity building for a pluralistic society, okay? Now most people go, okay, and we're back to thinking about this the way we have done for 40 years. So I want you to get out of that box for a minute and let's think about technology. What I would propose that we understood some decades ago that technology was an imperative in our society. Yes, the world was changing from a technological point of view. And that our institutions went about systematically building capacity for technology. And the parallel here is a lot of fun. So the first thing I want to do, and I'll repeat it so that the camera people can hear it, What has changed as a result of understanding that technology is an imperative in our society? What's changed around here? I mean, what do we do differently? Because we know we have to have capacity for technology. Wi-Fi. So let me ask you, if we came to the campus, we've been through a financial crisis, budget cuts, and there was no Wi-Fi around campus. If there was no Wi-Fi around campus, we would all walk around and go, what is this? How are you an institution today with no Wi-Fi? Right? And we design buildings. So now it's in the walls. We don't have to go add wires and string them all around, except for old buildings. Yes? It would not be acceptable not to have Wi-Fi. Now, the important thing here is several important points. One is we would not be viable if we did not have Wi-Fi, number one. Number two is it keeps changing. 10 years ago, that would not have been the criterion, right? 10 years ago, we probably would have felt really good if everybody had email. And I have never heard anybody say, when are we going to have done enough technology? I've heard that said about diversity. It used to be in the beginning, we said, how much money are we going to have to spend to get ourselves up to speed on technology? I think I will have died and gone to heaven if someone says, how much money do we need to spend on diversity? Right? So technology isn't static. What was okay 10 years ago is not okay now. What else has changed with technology? Think of current changes.
Online education.
Online education. Oh, every campus has decided that online education is the future. Well, you've got to build your capacity. In order to have online education, you're building capacity. How do faculty get used to doing online courses? It's not sitting there at Skype and giving a lecture, right? You have staff people to help the people do the online education. You've got to make sure that there's access to computers and resources. There's design issues. This is a big deal. But most campuses, and it's not clear that this really is an economically good thing to do, but it's clear that every campus is about to try it. What else?
Size.
Oh, yes. I mean, you know, I arrived at LaGuardia and I just kept saying, what did I do without a cell phone? Because I could communicate with people picking me up. What did we do? And it keeps getting smaller. The other thing, you're not volunteering quickly, but I'll give it to you because I'm sure it's true, social media. Enrollment management. PR. If you're in media communications enrollment, is it an important part of the capacity of those units to be able to engage in social media? Yes? We make an assumption that if we're not doing social media, we have just alienated half of our undergrad or half of our enrollment audience. That wasn't true 15 years ago. And in fact, I was on a campus when I was talking with department chairs about faculty diversity, and someone said, can I just interrupt the meeting for a minute? It was in the middle of the financial crisis. It was a public university, budgets were, it was just miserable. This person said, I'm from PR, we need to put people on all of your websites and all the departments to help you with design, web, and social media access. I've got the perfect person and I'm ready to hire them, but I need your vote. All in favor? Well, what did that say? Social media is an imperative. It's not optional. I was on a campus a month ago, and the server went down. And then I got up to speak. And I said, how long will you tolerate the server going down? So how long will you think you would tolerate on the campus, the systems that be, if your server, email, web went down? How long? Couple of hours. That's generous. A couple hours. Some campuses say 20 minutes. Get it up. Do what you have to do to get it up. Yes? Well, I've been going to campuses for a lot of time, and this is not quite as, I don't think it's quite as relevant in the most obvious metric as some campuses, but the disaggregated, the achievement gap in graduation rates is pretty appalling on some campuses, and it's been going on for decades. We saunter through the world thinking it's, I was on a campus, public campus, 10% of African Americans were graduating. I was in a room with about this many people. I said, how many people knew this? About a third did. I felt no energy and commitment. And, you know, I found myself saying, okay, I'm a white woman, I'm gonna stand up here and say this. You should have a sign on the front door that says no African Americans need apply because they're leaving here with failure and debt. This is not acceptable. Where are people jumping up and down? If the email were down, we'd be sure jumping up and down. So you see the technology parallel? It's different, but it works. And there are a lot of ways in the curriculum. Who we hire in this, we hire in the arts now, people who have media design and digital things. We have changed our notions of excellence. And it goes back to, you know, if you walked into a room and saw typewriters, you would think, how cute, is this a museum? I mean, we would just, it would just not be an acceptable 21st century capacity not to be using the technology of today. Is that enough to push the technology parallel? So here's the exercise. When you're having a conversation about technology, I don't care where it comes up, social media, Wi-Fi, servers down, say, okay, now if I substitute diversity for technology, would we ever say that for diversity? And in reverse, when you're having a conversation about diversity, I want you to substitute technology and say, is that what we would say if we were talking about technology? This is very, very important because we've been in a box. I'm a social psychologist by training. I understand the issues of the individuals and attitudes about change, and I agree with that. But the reality is when it came to technology, and I've been around long enough to remember it, there were plenty of naysayers. You know, when the early days of technology, people stood up and said, libraries are going to close. We're going to live in this virtual world where there'll be no more books and no more libraries. And it was a real doomsday scenario. People who weren't comfortable, didn't think it was a fun gadget and a futuristic thing, really imagined the worst for higher education. And it was sincere doomsday. We did not wait till everybody joined the technology bandwagon. It was an imperative. We understood it. Even if we didn't like it, we got it, that it was an imperative, and we moved on. That is where we are with diversity. It's not just about waiting for all lovely people to come. These are fundamental changes, and the question is, to what degree is this associated with your viability, your future, your credibility in the legislature, public, etc., for the state of New York? Where is it imperative for you? If it's not an imperative, what I would say is there's so much going on in higher education today that it's going to fall to the bottom of the pile. Diversity, technology is an imperative. Internationalization appears to be a growing imperative. So guess what? It keeps going to the ahead of the pile. So part of the issue here is to frame these issues as to why it is an imperative for this campus. So the next level of diversity work has to be framed, I think, in these ways. It has to be part of the mission. This isn't about my opinion and your opinion. We may have differing opinions. The issue is, how is this relevant to your mission, your credibility, your viability as an institution? It has to be part of core indicators of success, not an additional set of metrics that we look at over here when we have time. It cannot be projectitis. Alma this morning talked about the interconnected. There has to be a synergy. And you see this with technology. Now, we have chief diversity officers now, but the chief information officers, you know, don't run around putting computers on everybody's desk. They don't do programs for training. They make sure we've got a systemic approach. We coordinate, we use resources widely, and then they build the capacity wherever it's needed to move forward. That's where we need to be with diversity. Critical thing that I was shocked came out of most of the work we're doing, monitoring progress. We have to say, how would we know we're monitoring progress? And I'll talk more in the second session about how to do that, and how to do that so that thoughtful, educated people can do it and they're not scientized, we had to hire an expert to tell us. And diversity has to be inclusive and differentiated. And this is really important to me. I talked at the first slide about unfinished business. and now we're getting more inclusive. And for me, it's not enough to have the list of identities that we had. So for me, when I've challenged myself to say, so how do I think about this? I am not going to pick one identity and say, okay, I'm only about that one. Because if I care about racial injustice, for example, then I damn well better care about wheelchair access. I mean, how do I walk around saying, okay, I'm fighting for equity here, but I'm not going to fight for equity there? It's just not okay. On the other hand, if it's just a laundry list, do I get to pick and choose the identity I'm going to work on? And most of us will certainly work on the things we care about. So for me, the challenge was, how do I think about this? Here's how I would suggest we have to think about it as higher education. Inclusive and differentiated. And some of you in your back can't see it, but I'll describe it. So these are the dimensions of diversity as I think about it. Centered around mission. What is your mission? It's not about my mission or my thoughts or what I think you should be. What is your mission? And then there are four domains here where I think diversity can be seen as inclusive and differentiated. The first one on the lower left there, I think about, you know, it's funny, I can't see my own, I need me down there. The first one is access and success. And for me, this is about historically underrepresented communities. This is, to what degree are we diverse communities and what degree are people succeeding? It's no longer access, it's access and success. And for me, it's the historic soul of diversity work, access and success of historically underrepresented populations. Now, because of immigration, even that's expanded. And you know, we're academics, we can deal with multiplicity. You know, we don't get to pick one thing at a time. So because of immigration, you know, I live in California, I had not really done much work on undocumented students. Well, guess what? I'm not going to do this work if I don't learn and begin to address that. So access and success of historically underrepresented populations is increasingly, particularly in places like California with large Asian populations, talking about underrepresented Asian communities. Hmong populations, for example, which have historically been underrepresented in higher education. The second is climate and intergroup relations. And climate issues are relevant for almost every one of those identity groups. What is the climate for women? What is the climate for men of color on the campus? What is the climate for gays on the campus? What is the climate for a transgendered person on the campus? What is the climate for Muslims on the campus? I mean, we can be very inclusive in climate. How are we doing with different identity groups in experiencing the campus? And then intergroup relations. How good are we at encouraging people to talk to one another across these multiple identities? So that's a very inclusive dimension. The third, education and scholarship, is the heart and soul of our academy. What are we educating students for, and what are we doing research on? Now, I'm a researcher, and as transgendered issues or undocumented students come, I've got to do research on those things. It's not okay to be teaching 1950s stuff. Multiplicity and intersectionality of identity is actually at the core of most of the current work on research on identity. If you read articles on identity in college students, for example, and it's singular identities, you've got old stuff. So the academic core is, what are we doing to prepare every student here? That's the education part. Or from a research part, what are we doing to engage research? All of us. Every person, every student here is being prepared for a world that is that world. Well, how well are we doing that? Having simply people around who are diverse doesn't mean any of them are being prepared. The white middle-class student from central New York, how well does that person function in New York City? How well does that person understand that when you walk into New York City, you might have to have a pretty sophisticated understanding, if you're white, about race or religion or the Middle East or whatever? What's happening in the corporate world is that corporations are very frustrated with higher education, some of them not recruiting on campuses, both because we're not producing the diversity of folks they need, but also we're not producing people who know how to function in diverse teams. And what they're doing is spending millions of dollars to train people to work together in groups. This is a pressing issue. It's sort of like saying we wouldn't graduate in those old days people who didn't have technological sophistication, right? Well, today, leadership in a pluralistic society is not simple. Just because I'm a good person doesn't mean I know how to come in and head a university with its own histories. I was doing some work in South Africa, a historically white Afrikaans institution with its first black president. If that doesn't take skill, I don't know what does, to navigate a predominantly white institution as the first black rector. And this man speaks Afrikaans. So he has a capacity to navigate some of these historic things that I certainly wouldn't. So how do we prepare people? And of course, preparing people means we have to be prepared as well, which most of us have not. And think again about technology. Most of us were not born with whatever the new thing is. We have to learn it. You know, I often say if I get really mad, I go into campus teaching and learning centers are using the iPad, helping faculty use the iPad in the classroom. I don't know, have you done that here? Helping faculty use technology in the classroom, helping faculty do online distance thing. There are very few campuses that are helping faculty have difficult dialogues in their classroom, that are helping students understand the conditions under which we sit and talk to each other, in part because you go to a faculty meeting, we can't talk to each other. So what are we doing to build our capacity so we can model that pluralistic society as well as teach it? At this point, we don't know enough about, we don't have the capacity in most cases to do it, let alone teach it. And the last is the institutional viability dimension. And this is really your institutional mission elements, and it's also capacity. It's about the diversity of your leadership. It's about the diversity of your faculty. Where is diversity in your strategic plan? Where is it part? If it's not, then it's not going to be enacted. So that fourth dimension is critical for moving forward. And these four dimensions sort of cluster. You can sort of see the work that goes on a campus. There's outreach and admissions and student success. There's campus climate work for faculty, staff, and students, all identity groups. There's the academic core, okay? What are we teaching people, and to what degree do we have the capacity to teach any of this? And the last is, who are the people sitting around the table making the decisions? Doing okay? So let's take a minute, and I could do the Alma walk around, but just I want you just to take a minute and think about your mission. So in other words, it's not your opinion. It's not your passion with respect to diversity. It's, I have to get the name right, University at Albany. It's Albany. So what would you say are core parts of your mission? What is your mission? Volunteer. What's the mission of Albany? Yes?
Our actual mission, with social justice.
Is there actual social justice in your mission?
Yes.
It's in the statements?
It's a very long original mission, but in the original mission, it's down there.
Okay, this is really important. Oh, that's a nugget. Thank you. So somewhere in the history of the mission, there was social justice. And part of this is what I have to think about, and you think about change, is what are the levers for change? What's going to drive change here? And that will be different at a community college. It'll be different at MIT or RPI, right? If I go to a Jesuit institution, social justice is right there in the mission. Well, we don't have far to go between our mission and our diversity work, right? But it's not in your current mission. At least I didn't see it. But there may be an opportunity to okay. Let's leave that one as a potential lever. If it's there, bring it back. What else is the mission? What's the fundamental mission?
Educating.
Educating who? So, you know, at the core, all of our institutions about education. And here's the question. What are we educating people for, and how are we educating them? And I would pose that we have a pluralistic society, just as we have a technologically sophisticated society. And that change in our society is not any more a debate. That is the world in which we live. And it's even less and less an ideological debate. If you listen to the discussions within the Republican Party, The word was, we will not be viable unless we appeal to a broader constituency of the population. Well, why is that? Because our demography has changed. Not just in California and Texas and New York, but everywhere, upstate New York, rural parts of Iowa. So unless we're willing to say we can exist with a smaller and smaller percentage of the population, we're going to educate all of our populations, and the world has changed. So educating, and educating who, and then what are we educating them for? We got that with technology. We've got to push that with diversity, and it's obvious. We've got a pluralistic society, and we need people who have to know how to navigate that world. And that's not easy. It's not an easy embedded. What else? So creating new knowledge, or a research university. And part of the issue is part of the aim of a public research university to do research that makes a difference in the world? Well, let me tell you, there are a lot of issues that need making a difference in the world. I listed a few: health, violence, health disparities, education, I mean, lots of things. So the question is, are we doing that research? Do we acknowledge that research? Do we value that research? And do we count that research as how we are making a difference? And I think you could make a case that in addition to saying we're doing nanotechnology because the world has changed and this is the cutting edge of technology, that we live in a pluralistic society. You cannot be in a school of education, for example, and not acknowledge that. But it turns out it's in virtually every professional field, law, health, et cetera. So a research university, critically important. SUNY serves the people of New York. Well, who are the people of New York? You saw the cursing slide with the demography of New York. So are we serving the people of New York or just some people in New York? And historically, of course, we can say that we've only served some people in New York. Well, you cannot be credible. You cannot be viable. The legislature won't let you do it if you're only serving some people in New York. And we've seen this in California. As the Latino population has grown, the legislators have gotten more diverse. And guess what? The University of California, which had ambivalent, the regents anyhow, had ambivalent feelings about moving forward, all of a sudden is paying real attention to diversity. Well, why? Even with 209, even with all the legal challenges? Because the people of California are quite diverse, and the regents understand that to be viable in California, the University of California has to serve the people of California. So I just went through mission, language, anything I could find, strategic plans, and this is some of your language adapted a little bit. So we've got serving the people of New York. That seems like a good thing, and so you just have to disaggregate a little bit of it and saying, who are we serving and how well are we serving them? Student success, which you've clearly said, I put in, including in STEM fields. I think that has been part of the initiative in places like this. Preparing all students for participation and leadership in a diverse society. What students need to know is your language. Well, what do people need to know to be leaders in this society? It's not because somebody simply is a person of a particular background that it gives them an injection called, I know how to navigate pluralism. What are we doing to prepare people to engage with one another commonly to address issues in our society? That skill will be huge, but it has to be intentional. It's not going to come just because we admit lots of people and say, lovely. Now, because you're part of a state system, I went to the SUNY thing and read The Power of SUNY. And The Power of SUNY, it was six big ideas, Carlos. It's one of the most specially designed strategic engagements of diversity that I've seen around the country. It's something to be proud of, actually. And there are six big ideas. And health, educational pipeline, entrepreneurship, environment, healthier New York. So, I don't think we disagree with these imperatives for research, for preparing people, et cetera. It's really good. And next to each one is a box that's called Diversity Counts. And what it's saying is, how is diversity related? And we know how diversity is related to education, and I've already mentioned how diversity is related to health. A healthier New York means addressing health disparities. You cannot have a healthy New York if you've got whole populations of people who have no access to healthcare, physicians, healthcare professionals, et cetera, right? It's not going to lead to a healthier New York. So you can have the rhetoric, but you won't have the reality. They've got a box on diversity counts for entrepreneurship, that the ideas of New York should come from all segments of the people of New York. And the one I probably love the most is environment and sustainability. You know, the environmental movement has been seen as a classically white middle class movement, sort of the Sierra Club and going to the mountains. If you spend any time looking at urban toxicity issues in urban communities, you will know that environmental issues are huge in the poorest communities in our country. So in the SUNY statement, it says we're going to be concerned about the environment, about sustainability, healthy air, et cetera, et cetera. And it's got diversity counts. And there you see the intersection of who gets access to healthy environments and who does not. And so diversity is part of the mandate of all of these six big ideas. So what I understood and what I've read some more is that each campus was, you know, we don't deal with hierarchical decision making. Each campus was allowed to pick its big idea that it wanted to work on. And when I looked at the map, Albany seemed to be working on these three. I hope I've got that right. Educational pipeline, healthier New York, and entrepreneurship. So your system, you've taken on healthier New York, educational pipeline, and entrepreneurship. So the critical issue is, okay, how do you know you're working on it? How do you know you're making progress on it? And developing cultural competence. Now, there are some of these things that when we talk about metrics later, how do we measure that? How will we know if we're doing it? But you've got in there cultural competence. Now, there's a lot of research going on now that cultural competence is not the right word. We were talking about this earlier. And there's words in medicine about cultural humility. See, part of the problem is we've had stereotypes. In other words, if you're culturally competent, you know how Native Americans do something. Well, that's about as stereotypical as I know. We're going to take one identity and say, I know how you do it because you're of that identity. So cultural competence now is moving much more toward this issue of how do we navigate the multiplicities of identity? If you're a doctor, how do you begin to understand what's important to your patient? You can't know that simply because of the person who walks in the room. You know, they're not a single box. You've got to explore that. You've got to be competent to explore that, to ask the right questions, to know what questions and how to ask them. That's what's emerging. These are serious academic matters. These are not trivial. These are not superficial. And just like with technology, if we don't know anything about it, we've got to say, well, how can we find out about it? Either by doing research on it or by using the best that's come around. You've got cultivate collaboration and share our strengths. Well, how well are you doing? And how would you know? Engagement with local communities. How well are you doing? And if you ask them, how well are you doing? If I walk around to various communities and said, Albany, would I see a smile on people's faces or a hmm? I was on a campus that has in its mission statement, working with Native populations. The campus has a 25% graduation rate for Native students. If I walked onto the reservation, what's the likely response? Would you send your kid to this place? Well, if it's a 25% graduation rate, I probably would not, right? So this is part of the issue of engagement is, again, your language. But then the issue is, okay, you can have the rhetoric. How will you know? Create a strong sense of community. Be an attractive, vibrant campus that are inviting, accessible to students, staff, faculty, and the students. This is your language, not mine. And develop human potential, advance health and welfare, and improve the quality of life. This is your mission. If that's not made for diversity, I don't know what is. So part of the challenge here is use your own mission to ask how you're doing and to advance the work. So here's the connection between excellence and diversity, and people often don't see it. In fact, they think their two are at tension with one another. Are students from different groups succeeding? You've already said student success, so the question is who are we working well with and who are we not? Who's succeeding, who's not? Are all students, every single one, being prepared to function in adverse society? And here I would say to you, as campuses bring more and more international students, are we preparing those folks to engage pluralism in their own societies? We think of them as diversity, but in fact, many graduate students, for example, come from very privileged backgrounds. What are we doing to prepare them to go back to be leaders in functional societies where they're from? How attractive are you, and how do you know? Are people from different groups thriving? And again, we can be inclusive about that. We can take the identities and ask, are faculty and staff from different groups thriving here? How will we develop faculty and staff capable of participating in a global society? And how robust are your relationships with diverse communities? And are we creating an inclusive climate committed to the well-being of people? So this is something I'm going to go through in terms of pulling together the research. Here's what we know, and it's a very quick summary, because then when we go into the how will we know we're making progress section, you'll see where this follows. I mean, it'll become really obvious, how do you do this so that you can monitor progress, whether you're a leader, a department chair, a participant just saying, are we making progress? So what we know now is when done well, diversity is good. Done badly, look around the world. So let us not be naive that intrinsically diversity just yields good, because if we do it badly, it yields some pretty miserable results. But the research is really clear. When done well, it's remarkable. And from an educational point of view, it has profound educational benefits. And again, Alma said something about this morning. And instead of using the term critical thinking, which most of us are committed to, I'll use cognitive complexity. What the research on learning has basically said is, if what you hear is what you think you already know, you don't hear anything new. I'm comfortable with what I think, I'll take in the things that agree with me, and I'll discard the things that don't. And guess what, folks? We're all in that little boat. On the other hand, at the other extreme, if I'm terribly threatened and closed down, I'm not going to hear anything either. So what we know about diversity is it interrupts habitual thinking. It creates an environment where we begin to question the things we assumed. And in that little liminal space, learning happens. But the environment has to be such that we're not just banging each other, because then I'm just going to get defensive and protective and stay where I am, right? So when done well, it has profound implications for learning and change. And that's true of everybody in this room, not just students. How do we create the spaces to interrupt habitual thinking, all the assumptions we make, and yet not create a space that's so threatening that we're not going to listen to anything? Good education matters. If I were to summarize, you know, we have a lot of reasons and excuses in higher education about students in math. And being a woman who majored in math at Cornell, I can tell you, the research on brain research on women and why they can't do math just about drove me nuts. So, but I pulled together all this research, and I think of it as a stool, a three-legged stool. So when you want to think about conditions for success in any field, high expectations, this is the excellence part, do not in any way ever hear diversity work is about lowering expectations. High expectations, okay? You've got to promise. Belief in students even when they don't believe in themselves, and this is really important because a lot of the failure, as we've learned, is because people are waiting to be found out as they don't belong. Organic chemistry, mathematics, physics, whatever, right? So the question is, good education matters. If we think the zip code that you come from ought to predict your future, give me your zip code and I'll tell you your future prognosis, and we think that's okay, and I don't know of any educator who's ever said that's okay. That's what we're doing now. By and large, we are allowing zip code to predict success. Good education makes a difference. So high expectation, belief in people even when they do not believe in themselves, and the support necessary to get them there. Why do you think women's colleges, for example, have produced the greatest percentage of people going on into PhDs in STEM fields? A lot of women come into women's college and they're engineering and science and they haven't played with all the things in labs. They don't know what it is. Women's colleges basically made the commitment. This is true of HBCUs when they do it well as well. Made a commitment. We take you where you are, and by the time you leave here, you're going to be fabulous. It may take you a little longer to figure out what a lab thing is, which is what has happened to all of us on technology. I mean, I was on the Amtrak train and a woman conductor was telling a male conductor, how to, what was she teaching him? Something about where the contact list was on his iPhone. You know, sometimes it takes a little longer. So high expectations, belief, and support. Turns out perceptions of institutional commitment are important. That is why your president's comments this morning were very important. Now, we've had a lot of rhetoric about commitment and then we don't have follow through, so that's the problem. But if you are part, you know, there is no institution I know that doesn't have issues of racism, for example, right? I mean, we haven't created Nirvana yet. But if I'm part of a place where we're all in it together moving forward, I'm willing to do that. If this is another 10-year biennial effort to put a report together and then do the same old, I'm out of here. Because what we've got now on our campus is a lot of burnout. So perception of institutional commitment is important. It's got to be clearly tied to excellence and accountability. If we're not going to mark progress, then let's just not even pretend that we care about it. And this last one is increasingly important. Domestic and international diversity are related increasingly, partly because of immigration, but they're not interchangeable. And it's been hard for me to figure out, I mean, the technology thing I think works, but it's been hard for me to explain that. And somebody said to me, it's like you're saying, okay, we're concerned about handicaps, and we say, well, we put wheelchair ramps in so we don't have to be worried about people who are deaf. In other words, we've done one form of accessibility, so we don't have to worry about the other. Well, in some ways, we're doing that with the international and domestic issue. We've got all these people from all over the world, so we're done with diversity. And I'll show you some of your data in a minute that has me very worried. We know that identities matter. We know that diversity and leadership is important. Healthy communities are created with three M's: mission, mattering, and multiplicity. We need to know the multiple identities that we all have so we can cross boundaries with one another. We need to feel we matter, and that's true of staff, faculty, and students. And it has to be centered on the mission. We now know that myths and reasons in higher education for diversity provide reasons for lack of progress. I can give you any topic on diversity, particularly faculty hiring, and we will have the ready reasons. There aren't any, they won't come here, we can't afford them, they won't stay. And I'm sure you've heard those. And if you're in science, you've absolutely heard those. Well, I've done the research to show those are myths. And we could talk about more of that if you want. But really, empirically, this becomes self-fulfilling prophecies. And I'll give you an example of this. You have an advancement fundraising engine here on the campus? Okay, now during the financial crisis, there were a lot of wealthy people who were hurting, okay? Now imagine you've hired a new VP for advancement, and imagine this person comes and says, you know, we're in the middle of a financial crisis. And of course, nobody would disagree with that. It's not an easy time to raise money, right? But if that person said, I can't raise money, you know it's a hard time. I mean, we're all in crisis. What would happen to this person? They're gone, yeah? If we did the 1, 2, 3, 4 that Alma did, yes, they're gone. 2, they get to stay. You'd all put 1, yes? They're gone. For certain things, the server's down, it broke, can't raise money, reasons and excuses are not acceptable. Period. It might be hard, we might be sympathetic, we might have to taper our goals, but reasons and excuses for failure are not acceptable. Now let's just think about our diversity world. We're having a hard time recruiting certain populations of students, K-12. We can't find faculty, wouldn't want to come here. All of those things become reasons and excuses for failure, and we're perfectly sincere. I mean, these are not bad people doing this. This is not people being manipulative. We walk around with these embedded assumptions because we frame diversity as the deficits of some groups of people and how we can't, you know, nothing we can do about it. We're helpless. So if you begin to hear the reasons and excuses for something, then just picture the advancement person and picture what would happen to them. This is a really important aspect of the research on diversity. The faculty diversity research is really very important and very sobering. Faculty and diversity leadership is the slowest to change, probably of all the metrics we're looking at. The next generation is now being hired, and on some campuses I've been on, 2/3 of the faculty has already been hired because we've replaced with all the retirements the next generation. Fortunately, for the last number of years, most campuses slowed down, and now they're picking up again. International faculty on most campuses is growing faster than any other group, and I will show you your data. Turnover and retention turns out to be an issue on some campuses, not on all. So we can make all the efforts we want. If there are very few in my field, then I'm going to have to work very hard to hire them. Why would I want them to leave after 2 years? Or why would I want them not to get tenure? And what are we doing to make sure people can thrive and succeed? Graduate student diversity used to be a student issue to me. You know, we had student populations, undergraduates and graduates. Well, it turns out graduate students are the pipeline, some section of graduate students are the pipeline to the faculty. And it turns out on most campuses, the graduate students are not more diverse than the faculty. They're much less diverse. So it means that when it comes to graduate student stuff, we're doing the same stuff we're doing with hiring. Well, it's not surprising because most graduate students are admitted through departments. And most faculty are hired through departments. So all the stuff that goes on in departments goes on both for graduate students and faculty hiring. We've talked about the myths and reasons. There's always the story of one good year. I'm a leader. I get up and say, last year. So if Alma this morning said that Fresno had this incredible good year, what I want to know is what's next year going to look like. And it turns out that hiring is one of the central components of commitment to diversity. If I want to know if a place is committed to diversity, I look at the hiring patterns. I don't look at the words on a page, and I don't necessarily look at the undergraduate students because we know that's going to change. Now I'm watching, are we okay on time for this first session? I think we are. So, we're okay? I think so, yeah. Because I want to take a minute on this one. It turns out from the research that we have very underdeveloped reasons for why diversity is important. So why is it important to have diversity in the faculty and in the leadership? So part of that is sort of diverse experiences that create more better lenses on the student experience. Okay, absolutely. Yes? Diverse ideas. A man who spends some time with this list of the rationale, diverse ideas, decision making, and what was the third you said? Leadership. You know, actually it turns out if we don't have a diverse faculty pipeline, we're not going to have diversity in the department chairs, and we're not going to have diversity in future deans and provosts, by the way. We're creating pipelines here. And we see this for white women even in science fields. We've got a lot of departments trying to get more women in these things, and so you take an associate professor or an assistant professor who hasn't even had tenure or maybe just got tenure, and you make them department chair, and then wonder why they're not getting promoted to full, because we're so desperate to diversify. Part of it is also legitimacy, right? We live in a world where you can't not have diversity and think it's okay. Particularly if you give it the demographics of our country. What else?
It fuels the dreams of students as being realistic.
Yes. So part of the first explanation of it is the role models, right? And being able to see someone. You know, and my image of that is if I'm an African American male and I have never, ever had an African American faculty member, let's say in science, let alone physics, you might find yourself majoring in physics, but the chances of getting your head around a future in physics gets really constrained by that. And here I think the important thing is not just the presence of diversity, but the absence of. When I go to campuses, I often, it's one of the things academic leaders can do. Just take all your schools and departments and make a spreadsheet that has, this is a metric, race and gender intersecting, right? So when we talk gender, we're not just talking white women. Race and gender intersecting. And then just put counts. When I was writing my book, I did this for the top 50 research universities, and the percentage of departments that had zeros, absence of, nobody, was profound. So the absence communicates as well as the presence. And it's very important in terms of role models. And again, it's not reducing this that every student needs a role model that looks exactly like them. If we take seriously this multiplicity and intersectionality, who mentors whom is, but if you don't have anybody, that becomes a very salient thing. It's the absence of. Maybe that's the thing that's going to keep me from being a physicist. So it is very important to understand that these are compelling reasons if you care at all about not only undergraduate success, but graduate student success. How does one imagine a future in the faculty if one has never imagined oneself through somebody in the faculty? So this is the summary list, and you've mentioned many of them. Decision making, perceptions of commitment and equity. You know, every time an institution hires, it says where it thinks talent lies. If the only people that get hired are a certain group of people, then we sort of imagine that talent lies there. And if we're really committed to equity, we say, and we know from the research now on implicit bias, that we all have biases about our assumptions about who can do what. And it's not because we're bad people, we just live in a world that's very much marked that way. So perceptions of commitment, it means interrupting the usual. What's the reality of hiring, and faculty hiring especially, is we have to interrupt the usual. If we do the same, we'll get the same. It provides legitimacy. We know that much of the research that's done on communities, health disparities, education disparities, etc., has been fueled by the diversity in some subfields. If that diversity hadn't been there, sure, other people could do research. I do research. I'm a white woman. I do research on diversity. It's not to say you can't, and you won't. But the fact is that a lot of this new scholarship has emerged because we have diverse people sitting around the table reframing. So instead of deficit, Latinos don't value education. That early work on Latinos in education was that the family did not value education. The assumption of researchers is because they hadn't gone to school, they didn't know how to understand the importance of school. The research is, and this is true in the African American community as well, it's just not true. It's bad research, bad knowledge. You know, look at the growth of HBCUs. These were growing because people were dying to get good education. Dying, literally. So good research is going to be fueled by making sure we have diversity around their table. This is true in medicine. We now know there's a male knee. Did you know there was a male knee? Knee replacement's a big deal in older populations. Turns out women didn't recover from knee surgery as well as men. So a lot of the early work on this said women just complain more, or they'll talk about their pain more, or whatever these poor women were doing. Well, guess what? Turns out that the structure of the female body, on average, obviously everybody's different, is not the male structure. You know, the shapes are different. And it turns out the generic knee that was designed for knee replacement was a little bit over the bone of the woman's knee leg. It didn't sit the same way. Turns out people designing the knee were designing it for the generic human being. That's what happened with airbags. You know that, right? That the airbag was designed. So this is diversity in engineering. The airbag was designed for the generic human who was 5'10" and 160 pounds. So one of the biggest safety inventions in cars, the airbag, was killing women and children and small men. What happened is the car manufacturers, the engineers, the design people have still been working on figuring out how to make sure that when someone sits in the seat, the car knows that they're 2 years old and not 6 feet tall, right? This is a very real practical issue of where good knowledge comes in. My favorite California example is for good knowledge. California, majority-minority state, large Latino populations. I live around the corner from a drugstore that became Osco. Do you have Osco here? It's a drug chain. It's an Iowa chain. Anybody here know what some version of Osco means, not literal, in Spanish? Anybody know what Osco, some version of Osco means in Spanish? Somebody's thinking. I'll tell you. I can't hear.
You're asking what it means?
Yeah, OSCO means in Spanish. It's not a literal, it's not quite OSCO, it's some version of OSCO. Disgusting?
Yes.
Yes, disgusting. Okay, so I live next door to this drugstore that becomes Osco. Millions of dollars, logos, signs, you know what happens when a store rebrands itself? You know how much money that costs from a corporate point of view? Well, Osco in California represents disgusting, vomit, some version of terrible stuff. Now, why would you do that? And I have to ask, what was the capacity of Osco to know that? Was there nobody in that entire chain watching all these brand things and drawings who would raise their hand and said, excuse me, you're moving to Southern California, do you really want to do that? So the question is, did they have the capacity or were people empowered to raise their hand? So think of all the times you saw a disaster happening and you didn't feel quite empowered to raise your hand and say, do you really want to do that? Well, within months, Osco became CVS. I mean, you weren't going to do that. To me, this is about institutional capacity and decision making. And that is why these things, if most senior administrators had the lack of diversity that I see around most senior administrative or department tables, I'd be scared, because I wouldn't know what I didn't know. And I also am not sure that they always have the environment and the climate where if somebody was about to make a disastrous mistake, that somebody would feel free to go, excuse me. So what happens is, in fact, there was a freeway exit down here that was badly designed and had to be redesigned. You know, you sort of go, so you sit back and you bite your tongue, and then 3 years later, when whatever happens, happens, you sit there and go, yep, wonder how long that was going to take, right? An empowered, pluralistic community that works has people who feel comfortable at any rank saying, excuse me, this is important. And the last thing on this list is burden on tokens, cultural taxation. The reality is if you don't have sufficient diversity, the burden on the few is almost unsolvable. If I'm the only one in a meeting and I'm the one that raises my hand and I become predictable, it is not functional. So be very mindful that unless you get sufficient diversity, you're going to be in this cycle. So the implications for all of you, department chairs, planning, faculty, staff, whatever position you're really in, student success has to do with what are we teaching students for, pedagogy, the climate of departments and schools. Advising, we know, has to be intrusive today. This notion of I have office hours and nobody comes, gone. This is called intrusive. And actually, this is true for faculty mentoring as well as student advising. If you've got young faculty, people need, you need to be intrusive. Offering support, offering guidance, right there, not waiting for people to ask for help, all of that. Curriculum is critically important in virtually every department, because even in sciences, you've got teamwork, you've got bad science, we've discussed, and we've got the question of, you may have a very diverse undergraduate population in general, but I want to know how you're doing in physics. I want to know how you're doing in chemistry. You know, you're a large enough comprehensive university that if I'm not doing well in organic chemistry, I wanted to be a doctor, I hid organic chemistry, I have the experience many people do in organic chemistry, and the next thing I know, I'm in sociology. Now, if I'm in sociology because I love sociology, good. But if I'm in sociology because someone said, maybe you want to reconsider your plans to be a doctor, a loss to our society. And I can tell you our universities have lost. Quite apart from K-12, we have students coming in wanting to do this, and they're a loss to our communities and to the health professions. Difficult dialogues, support. I've mentioned enough gateway courses for you to get the idea. Where are people falling off the track? What kind of research do we do? And to what degree does it address these imperatives that the campus is supposed to be working on? Hiring, your program reviews. To what degree is diversity embedded in any kind of review that you have? How attractive are you? If I walked, and this varies from campus, if I walk on a campus and say, psychology, and I walked and asked diverse groups of people the reputation, do I get a smile or a frown? You've got campuses where, if I say chemistry, you'll see all this diversity flocking to it. Students and people know they can go and succeed and thrive. I say physics, Stanford once produced most of the PhDs in physics. The chemists were doing a terrible job. Why? Because there were people in physics committed to that. Now, unfortunately, when some of those people left, It was not sustained. It was not institutionalized. But the truth was told, you can produce underrepresented folks who go into physics if you mean it. If you don't mean it, don't even say. And monitoring progress. So what this means going forward, and then we'll take a break, and then we'll talk about how do you know you're making progress, is you need to have an organized way of thinking about diversity. Otherwise, it's a laundry list of tons of stuff getting longer by the day, because we added veterans. And I think we deserve to pay attention to veterans. And if I say, oh gosh, one more thing, well, the reality is if we're all doing it, then I don't look at the Office of Diversity and Inclusion and say, veterans, please, add that to your list, right? We can handle multiplicity. We need intelligent metrics, and I'll talk more about what that means so we don't get buried in data. Every unit of the university has to be tied to this. And if somehow you don't see how that would matter in what the work I do in your unit, then we need to talk about that. Because universities are simply the compilation of the individual activities of every unit on the campus. It's got to be central to mission. If we keep, the social justice mission is a gift, but I can't make the mission of SUNY or Albany my mission. What is your mission, and how does diversity become an imperative? That should be our language. It's not my opinion versus your opinion, my background versus your background. It's if we're going to be accountable to the things we say, if we're going to serve the people of New York, which people are we serving? Simple as that. We need leadership because we all need to know that we're in this together. It's not just pushing a rock up a hill, you know, the myth of Sisyphus. Boards need to be involved, the senior leadership need to be involved. We need to know that we're in this together making progress and we're not the lone voice or the small voice shouting. Because my view today is, after 50 years, if that's the reality, then do the work you do, do it as well as you can, build diversity in the things you have control over, and stop trying to change the institution. But if the institution, if I look at SUNY, the Power of SUNY plan, you've got a great gift there. The system said we're doing it. And the system is only going to be successful if every single campus is. So I'm hoping there's some pressure there to do this well. This work has to be intentional, aligned, accountable, and sustained. It's not a program, a lovely program we do. It's got to be aligned so that every domain of whatever metric we're looking at, we all have a hand in that. It's not a program or an office. It's got to be inclusive and differentiated. If it's just a laundry list, it doesn't differentiate the various needs. If I'm a gay person on this campus, I'm probably more concerned about the climate and domestic partner benefits. Are we marrying in New York? Yes, okay. So all the changes that come, that's what I'm going to be worrying about. But in terms of historically underrepresented populations, it's student success, it's hiring. It's hiring. It's hiring. We're not worrying about hiring gay people. We may be worrying about the climate and how people experience the place. It's not a hiring issue. For underrepresented minorities, it's a hiring issue. And that has to get reflected in the metrics. So that's not just a laundry list. If I'm concerned about first-generation college students and students from low-income backgrounds, from rural parts of New York, I can study that. I can look at that and say, how are we doing with those students who are first-generation to come? We have to be very clear about it so that we're not just overwhelmed by stuff, which is what we tend to be. And lastly, the global cannot be interchanged with the domestic. And in the second part, I'll show you your data. And I'm worried. Now again, I'm me and I'm outside, but I'm worried. The urgency is absolutely increasing. The viability of our society as a healthy democracy is at stake here. Our disparities are growing as a country, not being reduced. And if higher education doesn't make a dent in this by who we educate and what their opportunities are and how we function to model pluralistic, if we can't model it, as I said, is Albany going to model it? Is New York going to model it? How do we model this? There's a lot at stake for the United States and the world. We're one of the most pluralistic democracies in the world. Are we going to be a good model or a bad one? That's the imperative for us. There's a lot of frustration and cynicism and burnout on our campuses because we've been through this. Every time there's a crisis, we cannot do that again. And my urgency is the next generation of faculty is or has been hired. I couldn't get your data on new hires. But if you count the percentage of people who've been, or the number of people who've been hired as faculty in the last 5 years, as a percentage of the number of faculty, there are a lot of campuses that have already replaced 60, 70% of their faculty. You don't have 10 more years to diversify. You don't. So starting now. And let me stop there and ask for questions on this part, and we're going to take a break. And we're going to continue again at, you want to, let's take some questions, and then we're supposed to finish it, start again at 2:15, right? But questions, any question. And if we need to take a mic around, I think we can. But I'll try to repeat the question so the camera person can hear it. Yes?
I'm not sure if you're going to address actual protocols that we can put in place to address some of those very pointed points that you've raised, especially as it relates to our image as a global leader and our image in terms of STEM and how we're falling behind and how other countries are doing considerably better. Mm-hmm. So I'm wondering if you're going to give us some real solid things that we can sink our teeth in.
And what I'm going to do is, the question is, are you going to have some protocols, and I would add metrics, for how do we know how we're doing? If we're really going to be a global leader for various things, how do we know we're doing it? Is that?
Yeah.
And what the second half is going to be, I'm going to walk you through how might you know. And I'm going to give you some examples of how institutions know they're making progress, so that we can begin to say, not everything about everything. You know, one of the things I know about research is, if we want to know everything about everything, years, lifetimes, impossible. We don't have the staff, time, or money to know everything about everything. But that's not how metrics function, so I will give you those. And it's really sort of the way I guide myself in thinking, how do we know we're making progress? And we can do this nationally, but you can do it institutionally. Absolutely. Tamara.
I also wanted to share, see everybody's trying to take notes as I am, but we are recording all this, so we'll put them out for something.
Tamara said that this session is being recorded, so it'll be available. I'm not very comfortable talking about book selling, but I saw that there was I pulled together a lot of what we know about what are the conditions under which we make diversity work and how do we see it as an imperative. There's a whole chapter on hiring, some work on metrics, so there's more with an 80-page bibliography. It's sort of, if you want to know more about stuff, try to do it. There's new stuff, so we're talking about updating the book. So, other questions? Is this on point? I mean, is this speaking to the things you were thinking about? Because I want to be helpful. Absolutely any question. There's somebody sitting in here with a niggling, yes, please. Yes.
About improving the quality of medical education, and you know, we all agree that the quality of medical education is important, but one of the unintended consequences of that is that the historically female medical colleges and historically black medical colleges
closed. Absolutely. And, you know, go back to the technology thing. You know, it's not intrinsically perfect just because it exists, right? Technology isn't just good just for the sake of being lovely, right? There's a lot we don't know yet even about the unintended consequences for children of spending their life on computers. There's a lot of work being done on brains, and there's a lot of emerging work that you can't multitask as much as young undergraduates think they can. You know, they've done tests now on how good you really are when you drive and text. So with that, we sort of understand that these are complex and we're going to go and make mistakes. The question was about the early days of medical education, which had women going into medicine, historically black colleges having medical schools, and then the Flexner Report came out. And the unintended consequences, we now had to have trained professional doctors, and what looked like a trained professional doctor looked like this. and many of these special purpose institutions closed and therefore closed access to these communities to medicine. Is that a fair summary? And what's interesting, it's sort of like antibiotics. You know, Western world likes control, and we think with research we have control over the universe, and then we have to learn a little humility, right? It's like antibiotics. It was the best thing until we overprescribed it, and now it may not, right? We have to back off a little, because now we see that we've got all these resistant strains. Well, what's interesting in medicine today is that conversation is sort of happening, because what we had was, if you want to be a doctor, you better do this string of things that are going to be required, and then you better pass this, do this test and get high scores on it. And so what we began to privilege really was test taking and an interest in being a good student. And what medical schools began to discover is they didn't necessarily have people who wanted to be clinicians, who wanted to be good doctors. And yeah, so medicine is now rethinking, and the way they've studied this, it had not to do with diversity, but has implications for diversity, is some of the medical schools now have experimented with what happens if we admit students who've had humanities degrees, who want to be doctors, but who've taken sort of the core things. Guess what? They did as well or better in medical school, and they wanted to be doctors. They didn't want to just be PhD MDs. What's happening now in medicine is there's a section of the MCAT, which is the test for doctors, that's including the social and behavioral indicators of health. Guess what? Medicine has decided that maybe it helps to have people who want to go into medicine who understand that medicine is not just the cells that get manipulated, but you actually have to know the environment that people work in, the communities that people are part of. And so what's going to happen, and because of this, is that undergraduate pre-med programs are now going to validate and recognize the work of non-science. Literature, sociology, social and indicators. So we've had to kind of revisit the Flexner report, because it actually wasn't producing people who wanted to be the healthcare professionals that we imagined in those days of doctors. What we did is we went down this trajectory of academic standards, excellence, quality, which got reduced to test scores and GPAs. So absolutely wonderful question, and we've had to kind of so part of what I know about decision making is the more diversity we have around the table, the more likely you don't have an OSCO that gets built. You know, you have people who are committed. It's the same with the Brown versus Board of Education decision. The unintended consequences of that was black principals, black teachers were no longer in jobs. And despite the limited resources, those people were committed to those communities. So the more diversity we have, the complexity of solving these problems of our day, we're more likely to get rich sources of information to solve complex problems. And isn't that what we're trying to produce in our students? The capacity to solve complex problems, not single unidimensional problems where we then go down this path and have to come back and reel it back in. Thank you for that question. It was very important. And you see, it goes to the heart of excellence. The medical schools are not rethinking the social and behavioral indicators so that they can be politically correct with diversity. Actually, and in accreditation now, in the medical accreditation, it is now required that you demonstrate that medical students have cultural, and it's changing, the language of it is changing, it's more cultural humility than cultural competence. Why would you want people to graduate from medical school unable to walk into a diverse community and engage, whether it's gender or sexual orientation or transgendered or culture or religion? You know, the doctors don't get to match their identity precisely and say, well, I know that because that's me, unless it's you. You know, our identities are unique to ourselves, and the more experience we have with multiple identities, the more questions we can ask. We're sensitive to that. But we need to do that intentionally for all of our students, and certainly in the health professions. It's huge. I mean, we've all had the experience of walking into a healthcare provider who was insensitive to something that was important to us. Other questions or comments? That was a fabulous, very important. And I hope it just draws back the attention to excellence and that the world is changing and we need to think about what's needed now and not in the 19th century. Yes.
You've done a good job with identifying the salient motivators for diversity. Mm-hmm. What's in it for us to do? It's not just an altruistic thing.
Yes.
It helps achieve excellence.
Yes.
But that's not a salient that's served up. Right? It's still more diffuse and more indirect. And I wonder what kind of work's been going. You've done some anecdotal examples of Osco got this thing horribly wrong. I think some car maker sent a car to Mexico that said,
Nova.
Yeah.
Doesn't go.
Doesn't
Chevy Nova. Think about that one. Yes.
I just wonder, you know, this is a sort of theoretical bias about, you know, why people change.
Yes.
Why they do the things they do. So I wonder about the enlightened self-interest of diversity and making the outcomes even more salient.
Yes.
So that people would remain more focused.
Yes, and what I would say, that's a fabulous, because one of the things I study, and I'm doing now a comparative study around the world, is sort of what are the levers for change on institutional transformation with respect to diversity? Most of the world now understands access. You know, and we understood access 40 years ago. We opened door and then we said, doesn't work. We have to focus on success, right? So then we had a lot of change. So for me, the question is, what is the lever for change for the institution or the system, not for the individual? And here's the way I think we work, and particularly today, there are so many initiatives going on our campuses. I don't know about you, but if I hear another initiative, we're going to launch service learning, and these are all lovely. You could, if we were in a smaller group, I'd say, give me what your initiatives are. Service learning, sustainability, diversity, internationalization. What else? What? I can't hear. Community engagement, yes. Okay, so you get the idea. Now, I'm sitting, I've already had a cut and stab, or I'm just holding my own with whatever my role is. And what makes me, and this is me speaking, how am I going to pick this versus that for time? What we're learning systemically is what the levers for change, what it is not just enlightened self-interest for the individual. For me, it is enlightened self-interest for the institution. And I can sort of map whether some institutions are going to start to move because they have no choice. So for me, the issue is, why would this be an imperative? So if we think about Albany, we can say, what's going to make this an imperative? Not just something you do because you care about it, because we just don't have the resources to systematically call everybody's attention to something. And technology is a good example, because that was something that didn't wait for everybody to have enlightened self-interest. The scientists loved it from the beginning. But most people didn't. In fact, most leaders didn't even know how to turn on a computer in the early days, but they knew they had to. So that's my question. What is the systemic thing that will make this an imperative versus another initiative on a long list of wonderful initiatives, which I would tell you only will change if it becomes seen as an imperative. So money is an imperative today. We know that certain initiatives take off without even much discussion because they're bringing in money. So that's one. So for example, what makes it an imperative varies, and that's why you have to look at your institution in your context. So I was on a campus in an engineering school where the recruiters told the institution, we're not coming to your campus to recruit students anymore, because they didn't produce diversity in engineers, and they especially didn't produce engineers who knew how to work in teams. Well, that campus moved diversity way up at that point, right? So it wasn't, it's not just enlightened self-interest except for the institution. So here's what I look at here. In California right now, between the demography of the state, the legislature, if you're a public institution, and accreditation, which is now requiring for the first time in, you know, I've been arguing this for 50 years, disaggregate your student success data, please. So we can see how well you're doing with different populations from the state of California. That's becoming a big lever. And once you start, here's what I think about the dimensions. You can start on any one of these dimensions and it'll take you around to all of them. So for the question here is, let's do the one and two. How many of you experience diversity not because of your own views, but institutionally, as now an imperative for Albany. Okay? You know what an imperative feels like, because you had it with technology, right? We're doing online learning, we're doing iPads in the classroom, we're doing Wi-Fi, et cetera. How many of you perceive that this is, now we're about to become an imperative? No choice. You can't not do it for this campus. If you think it's becoming or is an imperative, raise your hand. How many of you think not so much? Again, you're talking about the institution, not talking about yourselves. Okay, so most of you think it's coming and we're not going to have an option, and that's the lever. And what I'm hoping is the power of SUNY. This is a case where I just as soon having the chancellor say to your president, the power of SUNY has the merit metrics that they are going to evaluate every campus, and all my favorite metrics are in there. So if SUNY is serious, you're going to feel that pressure, and your president will, despite, you know, you might say to you know your president is an African-American man, that he will push this. But he's the president, so he will push it either because it's an imperative for this campus, or he has lots of other things on his plate, right? Well, it sounds like you're beginning to feel this is going to be where you move. I hope that speaks to your, it is the driver, and it's the question of whether it's an imperative. My view is if it's not an imperative, not much change will happen. You'll do good things for students, you'll protect them, you'll support them. But I think as a country, it is no longer okay to have the graduation rates we do. It is no longer okay to have the lack of domestic capacity in STEM. The NSF, the NIH are now requiring all of that as part of getting a grant. If you're a campus that wants NSF or NIH grants and you don't demonstrate your ability to educate in these fields and reach out to K-12 for those fields, you're not getting grants anymore. That'll get our attention. Okay, are we ready to take a break? And we're going to reconvene at 2:15. Thank you all for staying with this. I know that this is a long series of sessions, and I want to make sure, though, that please, if you have questions or things don't make sense, or you're just thinking, okay, now what do I do? Because one of the challenges that happens with diversity is because it becomes about so much. We get overwhelmed, and then we go, never mind, unless it happens to be something we care about. And in these times of resource limitations, the image of, well, we just need more money and we'll do it, I can tell you that we've gone through periods of lots of money. We didn't do it then either. So it really is important to create the notion of how do we keep this manageable and sustained through time. And what's emerged from the research is really clear. Metrics, key indicators of how we know we're making progress. And there are two things I want to say as we start. One is, how many of you have an advanced degree of any kind? Most of you, right? So I don't want ever to hear you say, I don't know anything about evaluation, go get an expert. What you're really asking ourselves is, and I'll talk about this in a minute, intelligent metrics. They're, how would I know we're making progress? What would I look for? And remember, if we just brainstorm everything we wanted to know about everything, we'd have lovely requests for data of your IR office, which probably has one or two people in it. That is not the right question. We will not know everything we ever needed to know about everything. The question is, how do we take a temperature? And that's why you see a lot of dashboards these days. It's kind of the temperature model. When it's green, we're okay, just keep doing it. Red, let's pay attention. And the metaphor, the kind of the switch here I want to look is how we monitor our budgets. We all know that budgets are a big deal today, yes? Okay, now whatever your position is, whether you have responsibility for a department or a unit's budget, or you're a dean and have responsibility for a school's budget, or you're the president and have responsibility for the institution's budget, or you're the finance person and have whatever that is, what you don't want, unless you're really down at the unit level, is to know how everybody spends every nickel every day. True? I mean, it would overwhelm you. I mean, why would the president care if the art department overspent its budget by $1,000. President doesn't care about that. It's at too micro a level. So what we're talking today is about what might be the institutional level and school level, and you can see it getting more granular as you get local, right? So what are the key metrics? And again, in the first session I talked about technology, here let me just play with budget a little bit. What are the key metrics for a healthy financial institution? I just now made you the VP for finance or the president. You can choose whichever one you want. And you want to know how you're doing financially. What would you look for? What would you ask for? Yes?
More revenues than expenses.
Absolutely. At the minimum, we want a balanced budget. It would be lovely to have some resources to allocate to new ventures, so some positive balance would be good. That is known as an intelligent metric for finance. And at one point, I was talking about metrics on a campus, and an accounting professor said to me, you know, in my field, these are called intelligent metrics. And what he meant by that is they're not perfect. They don't capture everything. But in the finance community, these metrics have emerged as an agreed upon temperature taking, if you will. Yes? So budget balance, revenues and expenses, is an absolutely key basic metric on budget. What else might be another finance metric? You know if the institution is doing okay financially. What else? Size of the endowment. So in higher education, that's capacity, right? It's a sort of the stability and capacity of an institution is often indicated by size of endowment or endowment to student ratio. Public institutions were a little slower at that than the privates, which is a metric that gets listed every year for every institution in higher education because it reveals a steady source of income and a kind of capacity building financially that if you've got a small endowment, as you do, right, you're more vulnerable to the primary source of revenue may be public monies, and you know that goes up and down, and so you've got no sources. Good. Research funding, absolutely. You know, and this is where one of the strategic imperatives can be done in a way that doesn't invalidate diversity or it can wipe diversity off the map, right? You're going to become a research one and you're going to get research money and the metrics that count for that are absolutely counter to the metrics that count for diversity. But certainly for most institutions today, struggling to get research money, resources from other sources, and our research institutions, research money. Absolutely. And my NSF example is the example of where you can use that as a lever for change, because if you're interested in NSF or any of the federal entities that give away money, they care about diversity, it turns out. So yes, research money. Any other? Yeah. Enrollment, because it's a resource-generated thing. So if enrollment's going down, I gave a talk recently to a group of Mennonite boards of trustees. Okay, got the picture? These were Mennonite boards of trustees, and I'm coming to talk about the imperative of diversity. Okay, I'm committed to, this is about your mission and why it's an imperative in your mission, not what I think is a good, just good for the sake of it. Well, these institutions have colleges and high schools, so I asked for some data. Give me your disaggregated by race enrollment data, please. These are Mennonite, committed Mennonite institutions. The white population was doing this, and students of color were doing this. So their viability as private institutions were going to depend on being attractive and successful with diverse populations who might not be Mennonite. So they had to navigate, how do we stay true to being Mennonite and have all of these new populations? So enrollment, very much so. And disaggregated enrollment, given the demographics of the state. If you go to Ohio, I remember somebody saying to me, now Smith, you're coming to talk to college presidents in Ohio, and this is Ohio, not California. That was the comment. And I take those seriously, because I don't want to be stupid, and I don't want to come in and talk as if I don't get a place. I mean, I'm not from the place, that's okay, but I don't want to not do my homework. So I translated that. California is very diverse. Ohio's not. And indeed, when I did the census on Ohio, it was 80% white. And I went, okay, so why would this be an imperative to these presidents in Ohio? Well, because the high school, these were undergraduate institutions and the white population of Goa was there. And guess where all these campuses were recruiting for enrollment? Texas and California. Okay, so I have my imperative. How do you make yourself attractive to these new populations who don't think of Ohio as necessarily attractive? So enrollment, absolutely, thank you. Got the idea? Key metrics, are they perfect? No, but they tell us something that we have come as a community to understand as well-being from a financial point of view. The other one usually is debt to asset ratio. So if you go on a building spree and you've got all these loans, and the finance community has a debt to asset ratio. If you've got too much debt, given your assets, you could get yourself into financial trouble. It will lower your bond ratings. These are four metrics that tell the board and the president and senior leadership a lot of what they need to know at that level. Deans need to know sort of similar versions of things with a little more granularity at the school level. So that's what we're doing. What might be those indicators? And what's happened is, over time, we're beginning to see them develop and emerge. So the fundamental our remaining time together is, how do you know? And remember, you've all got advanced degrees. So the question is, how would I know? I'm not scientizing it. I'm not going to do research studies on it. What would be the indicators that would tell me we're making progress? So I've already talked about the intelligent metric metaphor. This is really important. And again, if you want to see a model of it, although it's not on the SUNY website right now, but the SUNY, Power of SUNY, actually has begun to develop a series of intelligent metrics. Some of them have yet to be developed. They're working on it. But again, you don't have to reinvent the wheel. They're working on it. Some of them are real, and we're using them nationally. It requires leadership. If people don't ask, how are we doing in these metrics, whether it's a dean or a senior level, then why would you pay attention to it? And higher education has gone through that with finances for a period, you know, where we just spent money and we didn't know why. Well, we're past that period. We're not doing that anymore. So it says take leadership. And it's also about meaning making. I can tell you, when I go to a campus, I ask for two categories of metric data. And I'm going to give you some of yours. More often than I like, I'm the only one who spent any time with the data, with my calculator and graphs and making meaning of it. What is this telling me? Now again, you can say you've misinterpreted our data, and that's fine. But what I want is for a campus to make meaning. So whatever level you are in, whatever units you're responsible for, the question is, how would I know how we're doing? Has someone given me the information, and have I made meaning of it? Or has somebody just provided me with a 300-page report or 16 spreadsheets? I can tell you that from you, I got spreadsheets, which meant I had to make meaning out of it. Well, I don't want to be counting your data, because if I'm counting it, you're not. And if you're not, then you're not making meaning of it. So this is really something where I don't want you to say, I don't know anything about this. The finance stuff, you're not a finance person, but you all understood those metrics, yes? They made sense to you. And you'd know whether you were going in good or bad shape. That's what I want, that's the mindset I want you to have here. This is about organizational learning, and increasingly across the country, campuses are really trying to do this, not from a blaming, not from a scientized, but just from a, how are we doing and what can we do about it? Again, diversity is a very complex thing. We may decide to do what the Flexner report did for medicine, and we think, uh-oh, we went in the wrong direction, unintended consequence. How do we correct? So the whole notion here is a group of people sitting down and making meaning of something and trying to tell the story about what this means in a way that has integrity and feels like, okay, I know we're okay here. So if I'm a dean, I say, okay, we're doing okay over here. I don't like what I'm seeing over here. And if you don't make meaning of it, it's useless. Just crunching numbers to crunch numbers is not fun. You know, at 2:30 in the afternoon, did I ever imagine years ago that I'd be standing up here telling you about metrics you should use? It's like getting a root canal. Really, it's not something people love to do. It's turned out to be critically important. And it's got to be linked to your mission. And so in other words, it's not just go about and say, it'd be interesting to know. So you're sitting in a room and someone said, it'd be interesting to know. I didn't want to go there because lots of things would be interesting to know. What are the things that will demonstrate, given our mission, given the strategic plan, given SUNY, the power of SUNY, given what we say we are, which is those mission statements I gave you, how are we doing? It's a kind of fundamental question here. So the whole notion of organizational learning, and you know, one of the cynical or disappointing things for people who study organizational learning is it turns out these academic institutions that are institutions of learning, yes, that's what we are, don't learn about themselves very well. I mean, it is a bit sobering. We find it hard to put information into our decision making. We each have our story. So we sit in a room, and particularly on diversity issues, you've got the terrible stories, the people's bad experiences at our institutions. You've got leaders who don't want to hear bad news. And so we just have competing anecdotes. And part of this metric thing is to say, let's step back and see how we're doing. If there's something wrong, we should probe further. But by and large, let's share a conversation about what this means and agree on where we're making progress and where we're not so we can collectively move forward and we're not just doing that thing I mentioned. It helps to unpack these myths that we have. When I've done my research on faculty hiring, for example, these hypotheses, these statements that leaders had on campuses, there aren't any, they were absolutely certain they weren't. I mean, they even had data to give me. Well, I did the studies that showed that these were myths that people had. And the question is, can we take that seriously and make meaning out of it? It also provides a time and a space, which we rarely have these days, to say, okay, what does this mean? And how to bring a diverse group of people together to make meaning? And that's where diversity councils and stuff can be very helpful, not in generating the data, not doing programs, but saying, okay, what are the metrics? How are we doing? And help the institution, because usually there's more diversity around that table than any other table. What do we see here? And then have a conversation about what we see together. It's also a great way to have the campus understand. You know, one of the things that worries me is when we make statements about our successes that may not be backed in data. So if I go to a women's college that historically has been so successful in having women go on to advanced degrees, and I say, okay, that if you're a white women's college, you've been very successful with women, meaning white women. How are you doing with underrepresented minority students in science? President's going out and saying that they're continuing that agenda to the future by the diversity of women who are going on to advanced degrees. When I ask for the data, the faculty say, actually, we have none in our field. Well, this is a dangerous thing for a president to go off speaking this, because all somebody has to do is find the data. So it really is important, again, not as a blaming, but as a, okay, we better do something about that. And it allows for building synergy, because now you can pull everybody in who has something to do. For example, student success. We know student success will happen because there's a culture of student success. It's not a program over in some unit. So we can share information and say, uh-oh, organic chemistry. Now this is really important. It has got to be manageable and sustainable for the campus. You cannot have a million metrics. You can't have them every 3 months. Or I don't know about you, but we're not doing that. The budget, we have a particular cycle, whether it's an annual budget or every 6 months or every semester. We see what enrollments are. Some metrics we get more often than other metrics. Our endowment to student ratio isn't going to change that often, but our enrollments, we may need it every semester. But it has to be manageable, and it means it has to be I majored in math, and we won't talk about what that experience was like, but one of the things I took away from math was that smaller number is more elegant than large numbers. So if you were doing a math proof, some kind of proof, and it was 20 pages long, it would get a terrible grade. If you could prove something in a page or three lines, this was seen as elegant. And I feel that way about metrics and scorecards. Do they capture something, and are they elegantly simple? Because if they're elegantly simple, we can sustain it. If it's miserably complicated and we're getting spreadsheets, you and I know that we're all too busy to make sense of stacks. I went on a campus, they decided to do a climate survey. The first thing they did, I don't think that's always a good idea, They brought in an outside person. The person wrote them a 200-page report with appendices, and I can assure you that in a room filled with this many people, I was the only person to have read the report. And when I read it, I had to say, so what would I take away? There were a lot of stories in here, and they were all true stories. I have no question about the stories. But what do I mean, for a leader, what does it mean I should do? So this is very important. Keep it manageable. Keep it to strategic elements, not just everything. Focus on where are the successes and where are the problems, and let it guide decision-making and priorities. The thing here, you will see metrics that by definition, many of these we've already talked about, are quantitative. There are ways to turn qualitative data into quantitative data, so you can manage it, but it's this issue about meaning making is very important. And in one of the early projects we had, one of my colleagues sort of, as we talked about report writing, this became very important, and I thought I would add it here today because I think it's it matters. So you're using both quantitative and qualitative data. So all the focus groups, listening things you've done are very important because they reach out and let people tell you what the place is like. And to the degree that you can align that with some other indicators that say, we're getting a consistent message here is important. And the meaning making is really important. Who writes the story? Who interprets the story? Who hears the story? Who validates the story? Meaning making. Who acts on it and who's accountable? And here's the problem. I'm the president. I'm going to the Board of Trustees and I'm gonna do my annual report. I'm writing the story. I'm gonna tell a story that's positive because I have to, yeah? People on the campus might read it and go, oh, that's a bunch of bull. So one of the things you want to make sure is when a report comes out, that people sort of see themselves in the report, that there's an acknowledgement about some of this complexity and meaning making, and you can actually say difference of opinions, but you can have available data that says this or that, right? So there's a kind of elegance to that, and PR and communications people know this very well when they write reports. The challenge for diversity is institutional success up here is going to rely on what happens at every unit on the ground. So the school level is next, departments, and then individual units, and then individual people. The reality about student graduation or faculty hiring is a perfect example. Albany's record on faculty hiring is a direct function of every single search committee. So if you've had 50 searches, president's not on those search committees, the deans aren't on those search committees. Every single one of those decisions, all of which have their own stories. We offered it to someone, they didn't come. It's all individual stories. The problem is the accumulative effect of that is bad hiring for diversity, right? So that means ownership at local levels as well. How do you build ownership at a local level so that it feeds into the institutional story in a positive way? So most of you were here the earlier session. So these are the dimensions that I talked about. Access and success of historically underrepresented populations. Climate, academic core, curriculum and research, and institutional viability around mission. And so these are going to be the kind of the framework that I use. It doesn't matter what you use, but to me this organizes much of what we understand to be diversity work. And then what you begin to do is say, so in each of these dimensions, how would we know how we're doing? It's a perfectly reasonable question. And here I just want to, again, give a tip of the hat to the power of SUNY. A lot of work has gone on at the SUNY office, I'm sure, in consultation with campuses. Carlos Medina is here from the Chancellor's office. Is that a fair statement? So you've got a resource there. In fact, you don't have to reinvent the metrics. Just look at where the system is and say, these make sense. And they did make sense to me. I actually think they're a very good model for you. So the first dimension is access and success. And some of the print gets a little smaller. But basically, this is the fundamental issue of the demographics of the student populations, graduate and undergraduate by field. So this is where you get into the STEM. No, it's not just the aggregate undergraduate population, but who's doing science, for example. And science emerges, it didn't emerge 10 years ago, because we're now in a national imperative about STEM, right? So we could find out about the demographics of every field in every school in every department, and we might want to, and a dean might want to, but really right now we've got an institutional imperative for STEM, so let's pay particular attention to that one. So then we have the success of students, this graduation, persistence. These are agreed upon sort of metrics. Gateway courses. If you begin to see that organic chemistry or intro to statistics or whatever gateway courses you know students don't get through, then part of the metrics for a school is to see how you can transform those courses so the metrics improve. Very simple. You're not going to major in pre-med if you can't get through organic chemistry. Do I wish the world were different and we didn't say that organic, well, that's changing. But in the meantime, we can transform organic chemistry so students can thrive in it. And we produce more doctors for the world. So again, you're selective because you know where's the problem. I was on a campus and I said, how are your gateway courses in the STEM areas? And the dean said to me, well, we're going to have to do a study on which gateway courses are a problem. Now imagine a two-year study. I mean, it was going to take that long. I said, you and I know that if I walked around campus, we'd have an agreed upon list of courses that are stumbling blocks for students. We don't have to do a study, right? Just make a list and look at disaggregated data for that and see what you can do with the faculty who are in that school or department. So this is what I mean about keep it simple. So we've got pursuit of advanced degrees increasingly, professional degrees for underrepresented populations going on to professional schools, advanced degrees, and then transfer amongst fields. So let's say you have a very good graduation rate and you don't have, you'll see, not bad for gaps anyhow. But what if you've got a lot of pre-med students moving over into sociology? Is that an issue? And again, you've got enough people in this room, people can tell you if you've got an issue or you don't have an issue. You don't have to study everything. Say, students are leaving science in droves or engineering in droves and they're ending up in some other field in arts and science. So let's work on that. You don't have to complexify it. So your first data point. So the first thing I look at is six-year graduation rates. Now, in my judgment, this would be the simplest simplistic. It's not learning outcomes, it's not citizenship, it's not critical thinking, it's just of those who start, who finish. And unfortunately for most campuses, we're stuck in IPED's federal requirements, so it's first-time, full-time freshmen of those who start. Now, fortunately, you have enough of those. I don't understand why every campus wouldn't want to know, so of those who start as transfer students, how many graduate? Of those who start as part-time students, how many graduate? I just care about completion, and then we can figure out time to degree. The federal government has made this a complicated thing by combining them. But at any rate, these are the data you have, these are the data I had. So my first entry point in a simple metric was six-year graduation rates, so 2006 entering cohort. The first bar is your total. You can see you're about a little above 60%. This is white. See black graduation rates? How are you doing? Hispanic, a little lower, but not bad. Asian American? American Indian, Alaska Native. Now, what we have to know about American Indian, Alaska, the numbers are very small. If you have four and one leaves, you have four and three leave, it bounces more. Again, meaning making. You don't have to be a rocket scientist to say, okay, let's look at this over some time period so we see about bouncing. But in this cohort, wow. Now again, this is debunking myths, right? We've got these poor underserved populations and they're not doing very well and why are we admitting them? And that's not what this story is, right? Now you might say we want everybody, we want the graduation rate to be 75% for everybody, fine. But in terms of obvious gaps, you don't see that here. This NRA is international, hate the word, non-resident alien, that's a federal word, less well. So your international students have a less, there's a gap there. And now we get the unknown, and we can talk about what to do about unknowns because you've got that in your faculty that's a problem. In the research I've done in some campuses where we can study it, it's whites and Asians. Whites and Asians are the unknowns. Okay, so if we were just telling, how many of you know these data, have seen it before? Okay, you see how many of you have never seen it? Yeah, I mean, most of you have never seen it. If it were me and I want to walk around about diversity, I'd want all of us to know how are we doing on at the very elemental, simple, non sort of starting point level, six-year graduation rates. And I would say at the institutional level, and again, I shouldn't be presenting this to you, you should have it, and it should be in a simplistic form, if I had my druthers, and I do get these data from some campuses more readily, is race and gender intersection. So you can begin to see how gender is doing across each of these racial and ethnic groups. And as you know, on some campuses, the African-American and Latino men are not doing as well. So then you go down a path of how are athletes doing? You've got all these questions to ask if you see a problem. At this level, I couldn't disaggregate gender. You can also disaggregate by people on Pell to get a little class feeling, first generation. But anyway, so what would you say is the, can you make meaning of this, at least at the start point? If we use this as a metric, not bad. Certainly not that 10% graduation rate I told you about earlier, right? So what people fear often is, if you're committed to diversity work, if we see that it's not bad, the institution will back off and say, we're not, we're doing fine, so we don't need to do anything else. And they're frightened, so the instinct is to go tell the, well, it's really not that good. Well, this data, not bad. Now we've got some, we're going to do some more looking. So then I went to the EdTrust website. Sometimes when a campus can't give me data, I go to the EdTrust website, which uses the institutional data that the institution gives to the federal government. I go online, they give me a nice little bar graph, and I can find out. So this is 2011, so the year before cohort. So we can sort of see 2 years in a row. And again, you begin to see, I wish this were a better light. But anyway, the first column is overall, so it's 65%. So you can see in those first five columns, not so bad, black, 70%, 69%, so a little higher graduation rate. So now we're going to debunk the myths, our stereotypes of historically underrepresented communities doing badly. Your story about African Americans here, at least at this level, is one you should be proud of, particularly those communities should be proud of. Latino, slightly less. So you want to say, how are we doing? Now again, you wouldn't be surprised in New York that maybe these communities. But now look at Native Americans. Now again, we could look at the ends and make meaning to be careful. We've gone from the 75% in the prior slide to 20%. Well, again, number small, bouncing. So we would want to look over time and make sure that we're not losing a picture of how do our Native students doing. Asian a little lower. Well, that counters the stereotype, doesn't it? So who are Asian students and how are they doing? And you see we can begin to ask questions. White students at the same level. Now here, the gender gap overall, not so bad. But I don't know if we disaggregated by that by race, whether we would find gender gaps within race. That has emerged as an important part of an intelligent metric. It's actually to do race by gender everywhere you can. And I didn't have that. So the issue of disaggregating data is terribly important because we want to say, for whom are we successful? And the only way to know that with these salient identities, for this metric, it's more race, class, and gender. And we haven't built class very much in, but we can. We're going to have to do that. Multicultural, on many campuses in the country, I'm seeing students of color. Well, in California, if you've got students of color, you've got a huge population of very privileged Asian students, right, who are doing fine. And if you don't disaggregate, you think you're doing very fine with students of color. But you've got to disaggregate. And I disaggregate down, so I want to see how Native students are doing. I just think, why shouldn't we pay attention to groups even as we aggregate? So you've got to think about that. The problem with statistics is too few. So you'll often see this in research. We had too few Native students, so we left them out. Too few Latino students, so we left them out. Too few African-American students in physics, so we left them out. And what I want to say is, when you've had too few, you could tell their biography. You should be able to tell their whole story. They're so few, and you can make meaning of it. So you don't want people to disappear, particularly on identities where you're trying to say we're successful. And now, with the multiplicity, intersectionality, race, gender, and now international becomes very important in all these metrics. It's just not okay, and I think increasingly you'll see class. And the way class gets, again, intelligent metric, students on Pell Grants. It's not perfect, because working class parents, say in Latino communities, aren't on Pell, but they're not middle class families. But Pell is an indicator. It's how are we doing for those students who have strong need. And you can do that by race and class and gender and begin to say, because you've got a big enough population, you can see how you're doing. This is climate. And climate, again, is faculty, staff, or students. Now, here's the question. How do we do a climate study? People don't respond to the survey, so you have a response rate problem. You have a ton of data, and you don't know what meaning to make of it, right? But we want to know, how do people experience the place? And it's sort of the quality of experience, the quality of interactions, and the perceptions of the institution. And I've spent a lot of time trying to think about this and look at the research and say, how do we keep this manageable? What would be the intelligent metric for climate? And here are my favorite five. So rather than have a whole climate survey, which people don't fill out and don't send back, if there's a survey you do that people fill out, students, faculty, staff, or you could have, I would make sure that there are these four or five, depending on the group, questions on any survey. So the first one is, and actually I changed the order in my head, the third one is overall satisfaction. So the first question I want to ask people is, how satisfied are you with this place? Faculty, staff, and students. You know, if we had clickers here, I could exercise that here. I could say, on a 1 to 5 scale, how satisfied are you with your experience here at Albany? Really easy, elegant. It would tell me something, right? And then I could disaggregate by race, gender, your school, whatever I wanted to disaggregate by. Would I refer this campus to others? I think that's a powerful metric. What's my experience, and would I recommend it to somebody else? I think that captures the experience at a place in a way that's very useful and can be useful to a campus. Imagine these data in a school or for the institution, for say faculty, over time. And again, you disaggregate it relevantly, so who is satisfied? Which group would refer it, is happy and would refer it, and which wouldn't? Would you choose to come again? If we had a clicker here, I'd ask you that. Would you choose to come here again? And I think if I said to you, depending on how you would answer that, if I said to you, does that question mean something to you? And if you could aggregate that over people in your unit or the school as a whole, wouldn't that tell you something? I'm here, but I wouldn't come again. Now, if you've got faculty who are in positions where they can't leave because the job market is what it is, you don't want a whole lot of people walking around saying, I'm stuck here, but I wouldn't come again. This doesn't bode well for climate. So overall satisfaction, choose to come again, and refer the campus to others, to me, are very powerful, simple questions that we could put on any one of a number of surveys where we get good response rates, and we could have feedback that's systemic. We can then embellish that with the more qualitative work we have, because if we begin to see there are issues, we now have stories to attach to these data. Perceptions of commitment to diversity turn out to be an important item for every constituent group. If I feel like I'm in a place that's committed to it, I can deal with the issues, the microaggressions, or whatever's going on better than if I think the institution's not really committed. Then I'm just alienated or burned out. And the last one is more a student one, engagement. You know, the NESI survey, people have using that a lot. And it's a good indicator of the degree to which people feel engaged in with faculty, engaged in research, whatever. So key items from a NESI survey, assuming you get a good enough response rate. Does that make sense? So you see how you take this big amorphous thing we call climate and say, what would be the intelligent metric that I could attach to it that would tell me, this would matter to me. If you had these data and you sent it to me and I saw that this group or that group, and with staff you want level of staff, I want to know how the grounds folks, who on many campuses, in California for example, represent underrepresented minorities. I want to know how they're doing on my campus. How do they feel they're treated? This tells me something about the climate. This is the educational one, and again, I've clustered this in terms of the availability of courses, the outcomes, this is what Alma was talking about, this is my learning outcomes. You know, what are people learning? Whether people are actually taking the courses that are offered, doesn't do any good to have them, but knowing that you have them, which is simply counting, by the way. How diverse is our curriculum? And the last one is faculty capacity. To what degree do you have faculty who are engaged in this work, in embedding it in the courses, working with students, mentoring. If it's physics, I'm not talking about ethnophysics. I'm talking about people who are producing students successful in physics. So these are the sort of bullet points on this dimension. Availability of courses. To what degree if we're not teaching, if we don't have coursework available, we're signaling it's not really important. What are the patterns of student taking courses? If students from all groups aren't taking this, then students from all groups aren't learning this. And what we're doing is we're getting the same groups of people in the same identity groups. This is not education. Learning outcomes, and the two that I think are very important here are cultural competence. To what degree are students prepared to go to New York City and engage the complexity of diversity in that city? If they're gonna, I don't care what their professional aspirations, teaching, medicine, law, corporate, artist, you better be able to walk around New York City and engage the complexity of that city in diversity. Are you doing that? And then difficult dialogues. I think any leadership development, whether it's faculty, staff, or students, everybody needs to feel like we understand how to design these things so we can have these hard conversations, which frankly, I can tell you that when I'm on my own campus, we do some diversity training, I show up. But it's not easy because I have an image of what it might be, and all too often it's badly designed and it's not what I want it to be. So how do we do this so that people actually are excited when they come out of these difficult dialogues? They've actually learned something. They've actually been able to ask questions of folks and understand better what's going on. That you really are hearing the stories of people. I think if we had more opportunities to hear one another's stories, we'd find many more opportunities to cross boundaries. But we don't take the time to tell each other stories. I mean, I could have a faculty colleague and never ask. So all I'm judging on is sort of ostensible things, things they say in a meeting. So difficult dialogues. And the issue of faculty capacity. And I mean that. We spend more time helping faculty build their capacity for technology. And it makes me mad when I see workshops on using the iPad in your class. Not because I don't think it's important. I do. I've actually gone to one of those. But the hardest thing for me, teaching in higher education, is what happens when we have the race conversation and someone makes a comment that makes the hair stand on the back of my neck, the class goes silent, nobody knows what to do, and I'm up there not knowing what to do. Now, I wasn't, in my research, was not educated in what to do in difficult dialogues. I've learned what to do. I had a colleague that I team taught with. We used to say it'd be easier to team teach physics than diversity stuff. And so the question is, what are we doing to help people do that? And part of it is people have to have the experience that this can, well designed, this can be an extraordinary moment of getting to know people and beginning to have those difficult conversations that our country fails to have at its own jeopardy. And if we can't do it, and here's the other thing you need to know about classrooms. Students self-select where they go out of class, right? I mean, you can't make me like somebody or go to a social event because it's good for diversity. Although campuses that do this well actually make that a very attractive opportunity. But in our classrooms, we have an opportunity for people to talk to each other. But if we don't create a fertile ground, we will just have the usual conversations we have, which is to avoid the topic. We have an opportunity. It's really quite thrilling. And we have enough work now about how to do it well. So building faculty capacity to set up the conditions, even in the science class, that teams and people can work together is very important. And this is the institutional viability dimension. And I mentioned it's the diversity of your faculty, the diversity of your staff, your strategic plan. What are the public perceptions of your institution? How does the community, what is your board's diversity and engagement in these topics? What is the turnover? And to what degree is diversity central? These are the core elements. And I'm going to focus because if I were to pick two categories of metrics that I want to first know before I know anything else other than your strategic plan and stuff like that, student success and faculty hiring. If we solved faculty hiring, our conversations would be different. And faculty hiring is simply who you've hired over time, who are your new hires, because the overall faculty composition doesn't change immediately, except now that we're hiring so robustly, it will. Retention, and I've developed a turnover quotient that's based on three numbers, so you can do it. So, example, you have five Latinos and you hire five in a period of 5 years, let's say. You have five in one period. You hire five in over a 5 year period. How many should you have 5 years later? Oh, come on. You have five and you hire five. Hmm? 10. Yeah? I actually do this on every campus. I get, how many did you have here? How many did you hire? How many do you have now? Now, let's say in the fifth year, I look at that, and instead of having 10, you have six. So you had five, you hired five, you should have had 10, you only have six. How many did you lose? Four. Which means four out of the five people you hired went to replace people who left. That's a turnover quotient of 80%. So turnover quotients of 100% for any population means you've all this work on hiring. There aren't any, we can't find them, it's a lot of work, oh my God, we got you here, and you're just replacing people who left. This is a spinning your wheels scenario. If your turnover quotient is zero, it means that everybody you hire went to add to your diversity. So we want to get closer to zero, and right? Now, I didn't get your new hires. That I really wanted your new hires, because I could give you a turnover quotient for every group. You can do this at the level of school and department. You know, what's the pattern of hiring? Because that's how the university will do. And you do want to do race by gender. And here's the important thing. Affirmative action offices don't do this, but the federal government requires it, so it's available. You want to put international faculty in a separate category. And why is that? Because it turns out that most of the Latinos being hired in this country are international. So you get, or you can, same thing with African Americans. They're not African Americans, they're African, they came from Nigeria, but in the affirmative action categories, they're black. Well, international people bring an international perspective, lovely, good, want some, important in a global world, but that's not dealing with the historic issues of underrepresentation. So some campuses now, instead of just using the federal government NRA, which means you're here on an international visa, which, by the way, in order to hire somebody takes a lot of money and a lot of work. Seems to me we're more willing to do that work than hiring people or networking for domestic faculty. But some campuses are actually using non-citizens. Not to disparage non-citizens. I would never want to be understood to be that. But it's a different perspective. It's bringing a different view, a good view. But in most campuses, it's the fastest growing group, international faculty. And we're not doing very well on domestic hiring. Okay, I was pleased with what I saw in that initial entry in student success. Now let's take a look at faculty hiring 2009, 2012, when I did this, the categories got so small and I was driving myself crazy, so I thought I would just translate. American Indian, not visible. African American went up a little. Latino, now this is interesting. This is what your data told me. Something's the matter, or maybe it isn't. Went from this 3.9 number to zero. So according to the data I got, there were no Latinos in 2012, zero on your faculty. Now, maybe that's wrong, so meaning making. My meaning? What the heck is going on here? Right. URM is the combination of Native American, African American, Latino, went down in that period. So underrepresented minority faculty hiring, not hiring, but the demography of your faculty went in the wrong direction. If we were doing a dashboard, we'd have a red. White. You know, other things go up, white goes down. Non-resident, can you see this? Blue, red. These are your international faculty. Look at that growth. This is the pattern around the country. And again, lovely. We want to globalize, but what we're doing here is we're saying, look at all this diversity. But we're not sorting out. These are international faculty. So for all of our, we hate searches. I mean, I don't like searches. They take a lot of work. Isn't it interesting that we're better at hiring international folks on visas with requirements and cost than you are with your underrepresented minorities? If you don't sort this out, if you don't put this in a separate category, some of these categories might look like you're doing well. Yes?
Can you
This is percentage of the faculty, and it's not new hires, so it's just, I did that, but this is a percentage of whatever the denominator was. So as a percentage, and I did look at that, you had, your numbers have gone down. Now, most campuses now are picking up with new hires. So I didn't have new hires, and so I thought, I can't do your turnover, I can't do this. So here's what I did. I did have the overall demographics of your faculty by rank. And I thought, okay, let me look at the assistant professors. In general, again, intelligent metric, not perfect. In general, assistant professors are sort of the newer hires. So, this is your assistant professors in the same two-year period. Again, these are not new hires necessarily, they're just at the rank of assistant professors. So you see African American going up a little. You see these are little numbers, little. Latino, zero. Gone down to zero in that period. Underrepresented, so it parallels your overall demographics. Asian American, down. White, again, as we expect. If you're mostly white and you begin to diversify, white should go down, and there's a lot of retiring going on. Look at your non-resident. And I want you to look at this line. It's at 30%. Your non-resident aliens at the assistant professor level are 30%. Translate. One-third of your newer hires, I'll just call them that for this moment, one-third are international faculty. Lovely from a globalization perspective. Adds international diversity, but these are not interchangeable. So what you're doing is doing it here, one-third. This is higher than most any campus I've been on at this level. It means one out of every three assistant professors is an international person. And again, international persons bring lovely perspectives. But look what's going on with your historically underrepresented, as well as your Asian Americans. And what we know, of course, is the sciences have been hiring, and there's a pattern in the sciences of doing this hiring, in part because graduate students are more international. So if we're recruiting from among graduate student pipelines, it's not a surprise that we're getting more international than we are domestic. Got it? Ah, thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. So for years, the number of unknown students was growing. So, you know, how do you, what's the denominator if you take them out? What's the diversity if you keep them in? What are you assuming with the people who don't declare? And I've done some research to say, well, who are the unknowns? Because a lot of college presidents say, well, these are multicultural people, so we put them in the multicultural category. Well, but here's a research question. How do we find out? So what happened was, and this has led to some practice implications, and you may have to do this with faculty. Students were expressing their racial identification at admissions. And because of all the controversy nationally, it turns out that most white and Asian students thought it might be better off if they said unknown than if they declare themselves white or Asian at admissions. We found some campuses that had SERP, which is the freshman survey that's done nationally. And we said, okay, we need campuses that had pretty close to 100% response rate on SERP. So the profile of the admitted class and the profile of the people who are first-year students taking SERP would be the same group of people. So we could see what happened to these unknown people, because now there were no unknowns in the SERP. Students had no trouble declaring their racial identity after they were admitted. And it turns out they were white and Asian, mostly white. So one of the implications of this, because the unknown is a problem category. I mean, again, eventually our racial categories, all these identity categories will disappear. But if we don't get ourselves more diverse, thoroughly diverse quickly, we won't know if we're making progress and we'll have problems. So the simple solution for the student unknowns is to simply ask students to re-identify themselves racially at first registration. What we know is unknowns disappears. Students are happy to tell you. So, and I can't tell you how many campuses think, oh, that's hard, we just carry over the admissions data. And if you have 30% of your students declaring unknown, you have a very misleading sense. So you can have a campus that sounds like it's half students of color. You walk on the campus and you know that's not true. So now you think the campus is lying. So now what's happening, and this is really worrying, is all of a sudden this is happening, unknowns in faculty. Look at your unknowns, the biggest I've seen, over 20%. Now, theoretically, and what I think is happening here is if this is done, so part of it is when is it done? If it's done in hiring, that may be another example of that. So again, can you redo it when people are perfectly happy to tell you who they are after they've been hired? It is also probable that some of these non-resident folks who are on visas have gotten green cards, have gotten permanent residency, but still do not identify with our traditional racial categories, and so list the unknown. I don't know, but you've got more unknown than most campuses I've seen, so you need to pay attention to that. But as again, this category alone will only go up if what I hypothesize might be happening here. And you just have to realize that while you're adding diversity, you're not dealing with historic unfinished business with respect to hiring. And this really matters, because the racial experience of an international person is often a privileged experience and very different. So acting like they're interchangeable is not going to work. It's going to cause problems. And I don't know, did any of you know this? That 1/3 of your assistant professors were international? Underrepresented minorities going down? Latinos disappearing? Now, you didn't have that many. You should be able to find out if they really did disappear and left or moved into some other category. I don't know. We can find that out. And this is an example where you can start with a metric that's up here and say, uh-oh, this is really worrisome. Let's drill down and see what's going on. So, you know, my standing back and recognize I don't know this place. I've spent a lot of time on the data I had, but I didn't have as much data as I could. But it doesn't matter if I have it. You need to have it. Your undergraduate student graduation rates have limited gaps. I mean, a little bouncing for Native American, I'd want to check that out, but at that level. I don't know about STEM, and my hypothesis is it's not holding. You don't have as much diversity in some of the science fields as you do in overall. That's easy to find out and important to deal with. From faculty, underrepresented minority down, Latinos have disappeared. International faculty, 1/3 of your assistant professors, up from 18% in 2009, sorry. I don't know about turnover, but it looks like you might have a turnover issue, and again, it takes three numbers. I don't have new hires. All you have to say is, okay, let's take from 2000 to 2012. Where was the faculty then? Where is the faculty now? Who have we hired in between? And you can calculate the turnover. Grad students is something I've tracked because I realize the grad students really are the pipeline for the faculty, and that's what your data would suggest. So undergraduate, very good at 28% underrepresented minority. That's not bad for New York, I think. But your grad students' diversity is only 11%. So again, when it comes to the graduate students, you're into this international, 16% international. Some campuses, it's 80% international, and particularly in the science fields. And again, it's not, the making meaning shouldn't be my making meaning of your data. It's for all of you to say, here's a problem, here's an issue, let's follow it down. And once you identify an issue, then you can go more granular. And you can leave the others for the moment and just keep tracking them. It's like the budget. If the budget's balanced, fine. But if your endowment is going down, you might pay more attention to it. So this question of how do we make meaning, often people will talk about benchmarking. And I think most of us don't know what benchmarking means, and I'm not sure it's always very useful. For me, I'd rather start with change over time. I'm less interested in starting with comparing Albany to Cortland to Stony Brook, although that's what the system will do, because then what the campuses will do is say, well, we're different. Cortland is in this region of New York State, and therefore blah, 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 where Stony Brook is blah, blah. You know, we'll get into one of those discussions about don't measure me against them. What I would rather see is just change over time. Are you making progress? And does the trajectory look like this, or does it look like this, or does it look like that? That's where I would start. You will have the comparative data, and that, again, no blaming. There's an opportunity if one campus is doing very well on hiring to say, well, what are you doing? So to the degree that it invites conversation, good. You can do according to some goal. There are campuses that say, we want a graduation rate for our students of 60% or 70% or 90% or whatever it is that you think is appropriate. So you can do that. How are we doing? So we've got the system comparisons. You're going to have the SUNY report card, I assume, and you're going to know how you stand in the system. But here's the danger with hiring. A lot of campuses are doing badly. So you may be better than a lot of campuses doing badly. You can do high performance. And that's hard to find because people don't share these data. So I wouldn't so much worry about running around trying to find that campus's data, because they won't share it, you won't share it with them, I'm sure. But change over time. And then your just general demographic profile you can always do. You know, how are we doing from a diversity? What's the, if I did a pie chart of your undergraduate students, a pie chart of your STEM students, a pie chart of your graduate students, you'd see some really profound differences in that. So, are you getting with me on how to make meaning, kind of simple kinds of metrics linked to a framework with central metrics? So we had the access and success, we had some climate, has some educational curricula, which takes more work on most cases, although you can just count courses, for example. You can do course taking patterns as well. And then for the viability dimension, for me, this is about faculty, staff, and leadership diversity. Very simple places to start. So it's a sort of report card. It can talk about progress. And this is, when I started earlier today, I said the problem with leadership is we need to mark progress. And the problem with people committed to change is we're going to shoot me down with where we're not making progress and we'll do this. What a framework and metrics allows, like with budget, is we have a framework, we have a set of intelligent metrics, we can honor that we're making progress over here, and we're not making progress over here, and we can collectively agree on that meaning making. So we collectively get to target our attention to the places where we want to make more progress. That to me is one of the levers for creating real change as we move forward. Because what we've historically been doing is just picking the numbers we like least or most and throwing them at each other. And that does not produce change. It just will not. This can, because it really allows a leader to say, I feel good about this. Now, folks, I mean, the chancellor of one of the UCs once said to me, we're the most diverse campus. You know, I feel really good about it. Just walk around and you'll see the diversity. And I said to him, OK, I walk around the campus. It's thrivingly diverse. It's a UC campus. I said, so if I go to the graduate student meetings, I'm going to see international students, not many domestic minorities. If I go to the faculty senate, forget about it. So at what level? So that's an example where we can just play games with each other. If we agree on these core metrics, then we can identify and be strategic about real change and focus of our attentions. Then you've got the recommendations, and I've read the report that the Diversity Council prepared, and you know, none of this will be surprising to you, and it aligns well, I think, with what that report says. It just gives some background validation to some of that. I don't have the climate stuff, but allows you to make recommendation and then for engaging. Now, the accountability piece is, if I had my druthers, president would say to the senior cabinet, where are these metrics in your portfolio? The provost would say it to all the deans, where are these metrics in your portfolio? Because that's where the change will come. Hiring, student success, the climate for students, faculty, and staff exist in schools. And if you hold everybody accountable, and people know they're as accountable for that as they are for enrollments, for research money, just a couple more metrics, really. Well, then we're going to have consistent, reliable, sustainable progress on diversity. And we've seen it in places that have begun to do this. So again, the same slide ending this morning, and this afternoon. Monitoring progress requires these elegant metrics. At the unit level, these have got to be tied to this. It's got to be central to the mission. It can't just be an add-on to other lovely things, or we're just not going to do it. I mean, we don't have the resources, time, and I have to tell you that most of the folks who do diversity work on most campuses that I know are pretty burned out and cynical. So we're not going to add new things, because now we've gotten the image, and say, now you do it. Like with technology, we're doing it. And it's got to be sustained. And this global is not the same as domestic. And if you need to talk about that some more, let's, because it's a terribly important thing to watch. And in your faculty hiring, it's hugely important. I'd say it's almost at the level of crisis. And again, what makes you attractive? Core elements of excellence. Success, inclusive, interesting work that matters, which is part and soul of your commitment as an institution, that you've got a good reputation, and that you're making progress. Are you perfect? No. No place is that I know of yet. But you can be demonstrating progress. And that's really what we need to sustain the mechanisms of change. And so that's how I see metrics. And let's take, we have time to kind of engage, but you have a sense of sort of the core. I mean, what you see is nationally, these metrics are developing as a communal understanding of where do we start looking. And that's where I start when I visit a campus. Just show me those simple metrics. What troubles me is that I end up showing them to the campus and the campus doesn't even know. Well, how do we make progress if we don't even know where we're starting from? So let me stop there and open it up to comments, questions, things you want to engage more thoroughly. Does it feel manageable or does it feel just overwhelming? That part of what I want to do is sort of parcel it down so it feels manageable. You can do this. You can each do this and you can ask this of the institution. Questions, comments, concerns. Are our deans in the audience feeling like this would be manageable? I'm putting you in the spot.
There's a question back here.
Oh, sorry, thank you. Can you hold this for a second? I'm going to get the mic.
I can talk louder.
Okay.
You understand that physics is international, participates in international collaborations, so it's not surprising we find our international faculty. I don't think there's any confusion there that anyone on this campus thinks that that means that we have diversity. We have international because physics is international and it isn't always happening. So I'm not worried about that as a crisis. The crisis is that we don't have the diversity in any of the sciences that we ought to, in physics in particular. But what do we do about it? You said that, you know, no excuses, but the reality is we recruit minority candidates and we can't bid enough, or at least we're told that we don't have the money to outbid their other offers, so they go elsewhere.
Yes. Let me, I've spent a lot of time on faculty hiring and now faculty hiring and retention. So the first thing, of course, is if you've got a retention issue for some group, you want to pay attention to that because they're already here.
The problem is that we don't have them to lose.
Right. So the myths about hiring are there aren't any that would want to come here, we can't keep them, we can't pay for them. And I have no doubt that if one tried to get Maya Angelou to the literature faculty, or Bell Hooks, or Cornell West, or whatever, that's probably true. But most people are not that. And what the research is pretty clear about is most faculty of, I mean, if we were really serious and effective in our hiring, the few in some of our fields would be bidded after. It'd be a supply and demand, simple economic analysis. But in fact, that's not true. And the research has shown that the folks in the most rare fields, that is science, accounting, and finance, in the finance fields, the fewer, engineering, you know, the fields that have few, less diversity, have less good experiences on the hiring market. And they're going sometimes, and I've done the research, into industry in part because they can't get a faculty job. So part of the issue here is, so how do we go up, you know, so they're there, but we're not getting them. And somebody on a campus recently said to me, post and pray doesn't work. And that is what many campuses do. We post and we pray we get diverse applicants. And what I can tell you from the research is that people will not respond. I mean, you put the ads in, you should do that, because who knows who sees it, and that's good. But people don't respond to ads just gratuitously, in part because too many have had the experience of being the token candidate, so that we diversify the pool, and that they were not seriously considered. What we have, I mean, what's clear in terms of practice is proactive searching, in which we develop relationships in our field. We're blessed in higher education in that most of us live in disciplinary or professional communities. We go to annual meetings. But I can tell you that many people go to our annual meetings and they don't know the diversity that exists even in their own fields. What we need to do, and this is absolutely effective, is begin to network the people who are in our field. Some fields are more diverse than others. But if you look at education, which has got the most diverse pipeline there is, it is not a pretty picture in terms of where schools of education are in some of our universities. Terrible. So as long as we think they won't come and we can't afford them. Now, here's what I would say. What often happens is we're recruiting and we have a final pool, 3, 4, whatever it is. All the diversity mandate is lying on this one person. Now, unless we've done real networking, what we're asking for is extraordinary stars to align, right? So I offer the job to that person. So now I think I've done what I can do. I offer the job. And then they turn it down. Now, why do they turn it down? Maybe it's money. Could be that they have a partner that's not movable and we don't have a two-career stuff. I mean, there are all these issues that go into decision-making, that went into decision-making for everybody in this room. But if you've got five, let me just go back some generation, white male candidates, the stars don't align with this one, this one, this one, and you still have one left. If all your diversity is in one person, you limit the chances that the stars are going to align, because there are a lot of factors, personal and otherwise, that go into why people accept jobs, right? So the more diverse your pool and the more you've actively networked, you actually know. I've been to the most remote places in this country, and people are there, and I've seen faculty say, well, nobody comes to our part of the country. We're recruiting in Connecticut, and they don't want to come over here, right? And I go, well, how did you all get here? And you go around the room, and the stories of how people got here and not there are very interesting. They're often family connections or historic connections. I grew up. When I hear those concerns about there aren't any that won't come here, and I hear it in California, which has the most diverse pool of people with people, and yet campuses that don't look a whole lot better than you do. So proactive searches, networking, there are a number of people who have written a lot about what a good search looks like. Now, one of the challenges we have with search, I don't know about you, but I don't like being on search committees. They're a lot of work. I'd rather post and pray, thank you. But it won't work. And part of it is, I was just on a campus which had cut all travel because of the financial crisis. And I said, this is a moment, because one of the best principles of good practice for hiring is to let people go to their annual meetings and begin to network. The other thing is the job description. My favorite example from a study I did, this was a Chicano geophysicist, so I want you to let that sink in. Chicano, not just Latino, geophysicist from one of the most elite institutions in the country. So he's got all the credentials. 100 searches he was part of and got no job offers and went into industry. Now, what is my hypothesis about that? Now, maybe he was, this is a story, so maybe he's terrible. I didn't think so. But the reality is the way we do job descriptions, so I did a study of job descriptions. Under what conditions are faculty of color hired? Well, in fact, if the job description doesn't embed diversity in it, 100% of Native Americans are only hired with target of opportunity hires, 80% of African Americans, target of opportunity and job descriptions that embed diversity in it, right? Latinos are about 50 to 70%, depending on whether you count language, Spanish language. So job descriptions become very important. My hypothesis about this Chicano geophysicist is these undergraduate institutions have decided the big thing missing in geophysics was this, and he did that. So there's the stars aligning, the exact subfield. So when I did the study, I'm a social psychologist, those job descriptions could have been written in the 1950s. It was sort of like we took out the old job description, we shook it off, we posted and we pray and we expect to get anything. So that these key elements of job descriptions, proactive searching, and then nurturing relationships is critical. Why would this be a good place for that person? There are campuses, for example, that are bringing people to give talks who are graduate students getting their PhDs. They're networking with all kinds of people so people get to know them, bringing extra people in who might not have done the paper cut. Maybe they started the community college and that just doesn't look as prestigious as Princeton. Well, but that may be precisely the person who has gone on and is doing fabulous work, but the paper cut didn't work. But they look okay in this, if you have diversity on your search committee, which most people don't, maybe you get them considered. But if you see somebody that has potential but you're not sure, make a case with whoever you have to make a case for to bring an extra person in. Often those people are more interesting. They didn't look as good on paper, they actually turn out to be better than anybody else. So those are those key elements of job description, proactive searching. You know, in the end of the day, target of opportunity, which means we're looking for people who do what we need done. And we're going to cater and nurture relationships of people and see whether they might be interested in coming to Albany. And I can tell you that that experience is not a lot of the experience of underrepresented minorities who are on the job market. They don't feel quite so bitted after and sought after that we think in our heads. That doesn't mean you didn't have an experience in which what troubles me sometimes is I was on a Cal State campus and they had a gender issue. So they offered a faculty position to a white woman who had had all her degrees from elite Ivies in the East Coast. So that was their gender hire. And she turned them down. She had another offer. The person they ultimately hired was a white male who had a perfectly lovely resume. But there were other people of color in the pool who had equally lovely resumes, but not as elitist as that one. And what begins to happen is we do over-scrutiny of these searches. We've seen this now. And we discan them, leave ordinary people in the pool. When that star-like person turns us down, we go to an ordinary person who's lovely and will make a wonderful contribution. But we've already eliminated all the diversity. I hope it's a long way to capture all the work one could talk about in terms of how to do hiring. But let me just say that it can be done, and it can be done well. But it's going to take being very strategic. So I'm glad to say here that there's not the confusion of international substitute. I'm really glad. That's a good starting point. And now there's the work of how to do this. And if you've got an office here who've got expertise to help you do that, they can't do the hiring, but they certainly can be a resource to you in your hiring. Is that a fair offer?
When you edit the job description, how do we do it effectively?
How do we put diversity in the job?
Yes.
Terrible. I mean, that's the bureaucratic language, right? We're an equal opportunity equal opportunity employer. So it depends on your field. So if you take this power of SUNY and you take, let's say we're doing something in political science. Now the reality is, you know, some people will say to me, well, we just hire the best. We make a rank ordering and the top ones. Well, what I know, because I'm a faculty member, I've been on many, many search committees. We argue about what goes in the job description in those searches. I mean, this is my hypothesis, even in a place like this, is you have more needs than you have slots to fill them. So there's a lot of arguing about what we need. And so part of the job description discussion is very much, what do we put in the job description? And we have all these holes, which hole are we gonna fill? The general rule of thumb is to try to be as broad. Again, the star aligning thing. The more specific you are, the less likely are you to find someone who wants to come here, who can come here, who has the field you want, and adds diversity. So the broader the job description, recognizing that people will bring lots of new things you haven't thought of, and that'll be good in most fields. So being broader is good. Mission. So, you know, if you think about diversity, the SUNY, power of SUNY, diversity counts. So how does diversity count in your job description? What does it matter? So let me give you a physics example. It's sort of easy to do literature, history. That's what, you know, the lazy way is you say, okay, we want someone who does American history with an emphasis on the South and slavery. Well, you'll get a diverse pool from that one. And it's a diverse pool. It's not just one group or another. But that also ghettoizes. So how are we going to get diversity of someone who might teach Shakespeare? But let me use physics, because I'm not arguing for ethnophysics or ethnomathematics. What I want, and particularly given your population, I want a job description that says, has experience and success in working with diverse groups of students in physics. And part of the requirement in the interview is, so what experience have you had? Where have you been successful? I want to make sure that you're hiring faculty who come in with the competence to teach diverse populations of students in physics. Why would you want to hire someone who doesn't really know about it, but they've got 17 postdocs, which I really do usually wonder why we need 17 postdocs, and really has very little experience except to be a lovely person? And then you find your physics numbers are dropping off. So I want to make sure that's an interview question, that's a requirement, the letter, for anybody. So if Daryl Smith is going to apply for a faculty job in physics, I'm expected to demonstrate that I have experience and success in working with those diverse students in physics. And that should be in the job description. It should be an interview requirement for anybody who applies. And you will increase the likelihood of diversifying your faculty like this. It works. It turns out it matters. Because the other thing that will do is it will diversify the pool right from the get-go. You know, any institution that says, we're serious about diversifying, we've got a diverse student body, and we want to diversify the STEM fields. What you will find is many underrepresented minority faculty have gone into the faculty because they want to create the next generation of faculty. You've already got a diverse pool of students, so they've got something to work with. I've seen very elite underrepresented minority faculty with Ivy League degrees turn down elite private institutions for public universities because the elite privates don't have much diversity and they really are not going to begin to create the next generation. Whereas they go to a public institution and they'll have more diversity, they can really do the work of diversifying the next generation. It gives you an advantage. Let me tell you, on one level Princeton may look good, but on another level you look much better. So by emphasizing that in the job description, you immediately turn the pool into something much more diverse. No. What? And how does it, what field is that? Oh, so experience and success. Okay, so now let's play that one out. So you've already put in your job description, we want experience and success in working with diverse populations of students. How good have you been on aligning that with the actual experience in selecting the final pool and bringing people in for interviews and their talks? How good are you doing? Varies. So that's the point, isn't it? So it probably varies by predictable departments. So the question, what, you want to? Right. So what, where do you think you are on that? Is it more wishy or have you actually, the comment was, if it's a mandate, then no one's going to apply who doesn't have it. So do you feel that it is a mandate in most job descriptions now and that the interview process vets people who have experience and success in working with diverse populations? What people claim. So the issue becomes, right, if people claim it and you're doing it, you should reap the product of that. Your data say no, so now we have to go in and say, so what's the problem? Are we losing people we get? We're getting people or we're getting them. You know, one of the most exciting areas of research now in social psychology that's actually being very effective on cross-country is this work on hiring and implicit bias. And I don't know how many of you had experience with this, but you know, part of the issue with the research shows that we all have sort of embedded assumptions. So this classically used to be done with research on women, which was mostly white women. So you take a resume and you change the name from Susan to Stan, and you find not only that resume being evaluated less well, not just by men, but by women too. So we now know that. Well, that same research has now been done on race by using African American names, or the names that seem to suggest somebody's an African American. Now you realize how confusing my name would be on the resume, which is kind of fun. It invites all kinds of discussions because I'm assumed to be a black male. Yes? But the research now is coming out on race, that even folks of color may devalue someone who has a name that suggests they're African American. So implicit bias is creating an opportunity for our campuses to say, how do we interrupt that? It's not because people are walking around saying, I don't want to hire those people. It's just embedded in the society in which we've lived, and there are ways to interrupt that. I mean, there are actually demonstrated ways to interrupt that. So part of the preparation of search committees, most campuses are not investing in preparing search committees to review candidates, and most campuses don't have the diversity of search committees because they don't have the diversity of people to be on search committees to make sure that somebody stops the process, says, why are we scrutinizing this candidate so much and not this one? So part of this is preparation. So one of the things to ask yourself is how systemic is the preparation of search committees to understand things like implicit bias and to interrupt it? It's actually quite important, and campuses that have really done good work with search committees find that they're much more successful in evaluating candidates and in hiring. I mean, the numbers go up. So there are a number of dimensions to the search process that are very important. It's not just going to be the old post, pray, we've got lovely, you know, if the job market is bad, we get tons of applicants, we do a quick scan, we eliminate anybody who doesn't look like our profile of an elitist and it's going to be prestigious when we get them here, you know, Princeton, Stanford, Harvard, whatever. And it's got to be interrupted. I mean, my work on hiring has been interrupting the usual. So this is very important, and what I would say is, you've got work to do, I think. And I don't know what's going on with Latinos, but you can't have the population of New York being what it is and gone to zero. I mean, this is zero. To me, this would be a crisis. This would be the server going down. But if you don't know it, then you can't even ask the question. And I suspect most of you have never seen these data. I don't even know if the deans have. Other questions? So do you have a sense of, if somebody were to say, what are the key metrics that we ought to agree upon? Again, you don't have to have an opinion about what they mean, but just what the key metrics, you begin to see them evolving as a result of what we've talked about today? And the other thing I would say is, I would start with what you already have. We underutilize stuff we collect, and if you've got it, use it, twist it, use it as much as you can. If it's terrible data, then throw it out. You know, one of the worst nightmares for a new president is to come in and discover that someone says, we've just balanced the budget, we have a $2 million surplus, and our endowment has gone up, and then 6 months down the road finds that it's all junk, and you're really in a $2 million deficit, and this is crisis making. And what happens for leaders then is, if I can't trust the data I have, well, I don't even know what I'm operating on. And yet with diversity, we don't operate on data at all. We just operate on whatever we think we know. And so it is very important, and to hope the data is good enough. Again, not perfect, good enough. And then begin to say, let's monitor. But use what you have. The worst thing you can do is sit around a table and say, let's be interesting to know, and let's do a study on. And we don't have the resources. And again, with climate, I can tell you that most campuses' response rates on the traditional climate diversity thing are 20%, 30%. If your numbers are so small, how do you know? I'd rather have something where I can get a pretty complete response rate. I'd rather have, for example, a very simple with some of those questions. Some campuses are now using sort of immediate response clicker to 5 questions, and ask people 100% in deans, in schools, anonymous, please answer this. And the concern often is, well, our ends are so small that we can identify somebody if we disaggregate by school. And there are ways to get around that. One of them is, most people on campus are willing to be interviewed, which means they're not anonymous. They're willing to tell you how they experience the place. There are ways to find out, how are people doing here? And this is critical. Otherwise, you will just trade stories and not make progress. Any other? We're a little early, which is good, because you've been sitting a long time, but I'm happy to just, is there any niggling question? If you walk out the door and you go, well, I wonder. Yeah, good, thank you.
The myth that the supply doesn't exist.
Yes.
Are there hard data that show up?
Well,
across field,
what I would say, what I would say is, we know there's underrepresentation in that pipeline. If take physics, accounting, finance, right, in certain fields. We know that true for computer science and white women. There are two things I would say about that. When my campus wanted to hire Peter Drucker, I don't know if you know Peter Drucker, the father of modern management. We didn't need 1,000 Peter Druckers. We courted Peter Drucker. When the UC campuses get Nobel Prize winners, they court them. So the one thing I would say is that if every institution, if all 4,000 universities in this country were going after those African American women in mathematics, there wouldn't be enough African American women in mathematics. What I know is, a good chunk of those African American women in mathematics have ended up at Spelman. Both because Spelman is smart enough to appreciate why it would be important to have an African-American woman in mathematics, but also because they didn't get job offers. So the perversity of this, and I once said supply and demand doesn't work, and a grad student at Berkeley said to me, oh, it works, there's just no demand. So it turns out the people who have more experience of being a better job experience, where they have multiple offers, are in the fields where there's more diversity. It turns out that the fields in which there is less diversity, those fields don't appreciate diversity at all, and those folks are going elsewhere. They're having a hard time on the job market. So it's counter to what you would think, because we live in this world of supply and demand. If there must be four African American, I can tell you, I was just on a campus, by the way, where the president, I said, more people know how many African Americans got their PhD in mathematics. And these are not people in mathematics. And the reason people know how many African Americans got their PhD in mathematics is to show you how few there are, and therefore we couldn't possibly get them. So I was on a campus and the leadership group, and the president said, but there are, he checked, there are only X number of African Americans in mathematics who got their PhD last year. Therefore, there aren't any, and what's our chances? And I was able to say, and I didn't want to embarrass him publicly, but they went to Spelman. And he went, hur, hur. And then, but he stayed in the room, didn't take offense at that, and later, to his credit, raised his hand and said, I just checked and they did. So I want you to, and that's part of why I've gotten so passionate about the diversity in the grad pipeline, right? So if you go to Stanford or Yale or Harvard and you look at the, I mean, Stanford is fabulous in its undergraduate student diversity. It truly is, and it's fabulously successful with these students. But if you look at their graduate student diversity, it's not nearly as good. Well, those are the future faculty. And we're not doing our job. We're one of the few fields where we create our own pipeline and we're not doing it. So those two things would go together. Yes, we have underrepresented fields, but people are not being bidded after, sought after, and to that degree. And we're not doing what we should be doing to diversify our graduate pipeline.
Talk about your piece on proactive search.
Yes.
Why are we coming and looking at that piece? Your supply doesn't just exist in university. Why aren't you targeting the industry?
Oh.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. Where's the talent lie? And in fact, in many cases, people have had bad experiences on the search process. In my research, I can tell you the qualitative make your hair stand on end in terms of how people are treated, and the politics of these searches. And either people, you know, are in a field, and let's say they're in literature, and they're African American, and they arrive, and someone says, "Well, would you teach African-American history?" The person says, "This is not my field." "Well, you're black, can't you teach African-American?" You know, so we do all kinds of, but absolutely industry. The corporate world, industry worlds have been much better. And I have to say to you, you know, corporate world got this a long time ago because they got mud on their face. For all of our concerns about legal concerns, the zeros in some of our hiring set us up for discrimination lawsuits much faster than the reverse. And there's a lot of talent out there, and maybe it's somebody, if you're in a professional field, you've got someone who's part-time and they come and then they make the move. People, what the research shows about particularly underrepresented minority who faculty or academics who want to be faculty, they want to go in because they want to create the next generation. And so the industry is often a second choice. But at some point, if someone says you need 6 postdocs and maybe you won't get a job, you go into industry, at least you can have a life. So thank you, that's absolutely true. And again, when my institution wanted Peter Drucker, it knew exactly where there is. I mean, theoretically, in any field where there are so few, you should know them all. They should feel courted. You should be going and reading their papers. And again, people don't want to be just taken seriously because of their identity. They want to be taken seriously because of their research. And I can tell you, for a lot of scholars, one of the biggest turnoffs is, you know, a grad advisor says, "Oh, you're black, you'll have no trouble." That is so infuriating because it's not true, but it also means you're devaluing the work they've done to get their PhDs. In my field, plenty of diversity. I read people's articles. I know whether they kind of bring what we need broad because I've read their scholarship and I can talk about it and go to a meeting and I meet them. Now you have a relationship. It's a very different search process. Does it take more time? That's why we hire headhunters for so many domains in our institution. Searches are, I'm repeating it, you said, intricate and an important industry because finding talent that will thrive in your environment with your mission is your highest priority. It's not post and pray. And we've all had horror stories to back that up. And that comes from building relationships. People need to feel they're going to matter when they come, that they're valued. And that you value their work. And of course that begins to go. We don't value the research, we think it's second, you know, if you do work in the community, that's not as good as something else, all of that. Yes. Yes.
So for a lot of people, they might hear about that,
Absolutely.
So, it's important to keep that in mind that go both ways, and that means to really both mindful but conscious of the way that the people that are currently on that campus are being treated, so that we can,
Absolutely. Well, and part of one of the indicators on the fourth dimension is perceptions of the campus. So one of the interesting questions is, how can we get a sense of how people perceive us? One of the worst things campuses do is somebody from the community on the campus will say, we've got some problems of how people are treated, and what they experience is being dismissed as troublemakers or complainers or something. So part of the question here is, how do you begin to hear? And how do you begin to get a sense, those climate indicators? Would you come again? Would you recommend it to a friend? Well, I'd want to know if I think that, for example, the city of Albany has had racist police practice. I mean, I know none of this. Racist police practices, or the institution has had a bad reputation. First, I want to say, if people are here, how you doing? One of the worst and most troubling things, I was on a campus, and a young, untenured Latino faculty member said, I don't know what to do. This is a very miserable place to be, but everybody expects me to meet with the Latino candidates and sell them on coming. And I don't know what to do. I'm on tenured. So the first thing for me would be, this is qualitative, you don't have that many. I wanted, who would people on my campus tell the truth to? Because people are not going to walk around just telling anybody. So it can be heard, and then the story can be told. How are we doing with people who are here? And we might, in fact, say, we've got to turn that around so they become good ambassadors, and they can say, yes, 10 years ago this was an issue. Or yes, Albany is a terrible place, but the campus is wonderful. Or it used to be not so wonderful, but now it is wonderful. I mean, that requires some information about how are people experiencing, a willingness to hear the truth, a freedom to tell the truth, and then a willingness to be proactive. And so think about many opportunities we have on our campus. We have an incident and we've got to handle the PR. Well, you want a truthful PR, right? How do we manage that? The starting point to me would be, well, how are we doing with the people who are here? The other thing that I've found myself talking about, there's not much research on it, but I've been an administrator long enough. If I look at turnover issues, even on large campuses, we know which are toxic environments for different identity groups. I know which environments or which departments I don't think I'd wish any woman to go into of any background. Yes? We know they're where they are. Or they've just had turnover, they can't keep people. Well, I think where we are at this point, I think we're at the point in higher education where we should tolerate, we cannot tolerate bullying anymore, we can't tolerate people doing inappropriate behavior. I don't care about tenure and academic freedom. Yes, we have that, but we have to call each other on professional conduct, right? Well, one of the levers of change is I want my search, if I'm in a department and someone leaves and I want, or a new position, if the leader, this is where leadership has to come in. If I know that this is a toxic environment and they have no historic record of nurturing, mentoring particular groups of diverse faculty, then I have to say, I don't care what they need. You don't get to have a search until you create a climate in which I can be assured that this rarefied person who is so special and so unusual, I'm not just throwing them to the wolves to be chewed up and spit out, right? I mean, this should be seen as a value. And I think we haven't done that in many cases. We've just, and I think it's, if people get called on it, actually people sometimes rise to the occasion. I begin to think that campuses should develop, if they've got a retention issue, memoranda of understanding. So the obligation of the department that's going to hire is not only a case for why you need a hire, but what you will do to make sure that that person thrives when they come. Mentor, deal with climate, support network, collaborative, whatever you need to do. What are you going to do to see that this person, and it could be for any faculty member, but it will help the diversity piece to ensure that you've got the right kind of environment for people to thrive. So think of, that's a very important question. And my guess is, I was on a campus recently and someone said, well, can you tell us which are the toxic departments? And I said, just like you could tell me which are the gateway courses that are problematic, you can tell me which are the toxic. I mean, we know, but we have not been courageous enough to sit down with a department chair or whatever and say, your record here of chewing people up and spitting people out, your reputation on the campus for students or for faculty is not good. And, you know, if we're going to put resources into this, I want you to demonstrate that you can turn that around. And then you've got a story to tell about a turnaround, right? And it makes it easier for people to recruit because maybe they're hopeful that they're recruiting people to build something new and not just inviting people in. Thank you, that's a... This is often where the retention issues lie. So the first step is, do we have one? It's where the climate tells us, how are we doing? And if we're not doing well with people we have, why do we think we're going to do well with people we're going to recruit? Unless we ask people to lie. And that's untenable. Any other niggling questions? Well, I think you have been so, you've been here, and it's been a long day, and I really appreciate that. We're a few minutes early, which never hurts because we had a good period of time, but I've been asked to remind you that there are evaluations sitting on the table, and you know they had session one and session two, but if you want to just give your comments for both, either or, that would be fine. And thank you very, very much.